Gary Patterson in his 15th season at the helm. Might have his best team. That's saying something. His 2010 squad, led by Andy Dalton, went undefeated and won the Rose Bowl. Jerry Kills in his fifth year at Minnesota. Big Ten Coach of the Year in 2014. Consecutive eight-win seasons. And this has been the Nissan pregame rush. TCU won the toss and elected to defer. We'll have to wait a bit to see Trevon Boykin. Minnesota will receive. Jalen Myrick and Antonio Johnson are deep. This will be a touchback and will come out to the 25 for Minnesota. The quarterback for the Golden Gophers is Mitch Leidner. He's a big kid, was a defensive end in high school. 17th career start, a record of 10-6 coming in. Very involved in their run game. 17 career rushing touchdowns, including 10 last year. He only had 8 interceptions last season, but 3 of those came in their 30-7 loss at TCU. He was banged up in that game. Did not play well, though.
He's been waiting a whole year to get another shot at this TCU defense. As you mentioned, he had a banged up knee, wasn't real mobile, and that takes a lot out of his game.
Grew up about 30 minutes from the Minnesota campus, and he's going to throw on first down. And the catch is made by 6'10", 270-pound tight end Nate Wozniak. A gain of a handful.
Right off the bat, you see Minnesota coming out, throwing the football, trying to get Mitch Leidner in his comfort zone, get his new tight end. Remember, no Max Williams. He's gone to the NFL. No David Cobb. They've got to find playmakers, and they've been really impressed with Wozniak in camp.
Roderick Williams is Cobb's replacement at running back. He'll get the carry here. And he runs into a wall at the 32-yard line, picked up just a couple. Chris Bradley on the stop. So a third down. This will be important here. Try to keep that potent TCU offense on the sideline. Keep the chains moving for the Minnesota Gopher.
There's been a lot of talk this offseason in spring and fall about Minnesota maybe using some no huddle. This coaching staff will not do it unless they get a first down. If you get a first down, Jerry Kill is interested in exploring some no huddle on offense.
So a third down and 3. And Leidner with time. And it's a first down catch by Eric Carter. And only one catch a year ago, and that was at TCU.
And here they go with the hurry up. That first down is critical in any no huddle system.
And it's the quarterback run. Leidner with a big hole. Well, he could not break the Mike Freeze tackle. Here they go again after that gain of about 7.
And this is Jerry Kill trying to catch TCU off guard. Gary Patterson, this defense, you don't expect this from Minnesota offensive.
Another pass play. Leidner dumping it off to Williams. And Williams with a beautiful move gets the first down to midfield.
Feel the energy of this offense. They're getting this crowd into the game.
A good start for Minnesota against the number 2 team in college football entering the regular season, TCU. The Gophers with a couple of first downs, and they're on the cusp of getting into Horned Frog territory. Quarterback run for Mitch Leidner, and he picks up a couple of yards. TCU is playing without 2 of its top players on defense. Davion Pearson, preseason All-Big 12, out with an injury. James McFarland, MVP of their bowl game last year, he's out with an injury. And they already lost 6 starters from last year's defense.
That's on top of those 6 starters. There's McFarland, an impact player, especially in the passing game, getting after the passer. But you said Paul Dawson, that middle linebacker, was a heart and soul of this defense a year ago. They were outstanding, 8th in the country in scoring defense. They have got to find a replacement.
Rodney Smith trying to bounce it to the outside. Josh Caraway and the safety Derek Kindred, their top returning tackler from a year ago, made the stop. So now we have a 3rd and long.
And again, this Minnesota offense has already shown something different in this first drive. They get a first down, they go hurry up, which they did none of a year ago. Now they've gotten themselves across midfield, bring up a 3rd and 8 situation. This is where Mitch Leidner struggled last year on the road against TCU, turning the football over. You have to be smart with the ball.
Yeah, three of his eight picks last season came against TCU. That was in game number two. He played much better, though, as the year went on. And he converted a third and eight through the air. Has time to throw, and it's dropped by K.J. May. Might not have gotten the first down anyway. So fourth down. They do have an excellent punter in Peter Mortel that will come on here for the Gopher.
Yeah, this was just lack of timing here. Leidner wants to throw the ball, throws it a little early before K.J. May comes out of his break, and then it's behind him on his knee. That's a tough catch, especially with Denzel Johnson bearing down.
Mortel was an all-Big Ten punter last season. And Kevontae Turpin, a true freshman, is the return man for TCU. And he was signaling for the fair catch basically as it left the punter's foot. His first collegiate touch. And welcome to the booth alongside Brian Greasy. I'm Dave Pasch. Tom Luganville down on the field throughout the game. And, you know, Brian, for TCU this year, a ton of expectations. A 180 from last year, and nobody thought anything of the Horned Frogs. They won only four games in 2013. And the reason is they've got 10 starters back on offense. And a Heisman Trophy candidate, a quarterback.
Yeah, and some questions on the defensive side, as we talked about. There's no question about the offense. Trevon Boykin, what a special year he had a year ago. He might even be better this season, Dave. In his second year in Sonny Cumbie and Doug Meacham's system, I can't wait to watch with this kid how he can continue to grow and mature as a quarterback in this system.
TCU backed up, and Boykin on first down finds his top receiver, Josh Dotson, who set the school record last year for receiving yards. Boykin set a number of school records for passing, almost 4,000 passing yards, 33 touchdowns. Remember, he played a lot of wide receiver a couple years ago, so they weren't sure what they'd get out of him last year as a QB, and he was the Big 12 Player of the Year. Boykin on the move and close to a first down at the 19. Devondre Campbell made the tackle.
There's a corner fire, Dave. Grit blitz by Minnesota, you see, but the athleticism. You cannot leave the ground on Trevon Boykin, who will make you pay.
That was Boykin straight ahead getting the first down for TCU.
Just so dangerous. We know he can throw the football. The thing that jumps out on the film is the deep ball, because he has such speed on the outside with Colby Lissenby and Josh Dotson. But the decision-making, talking with Sonny Cumbie yesterday, his decision-making over the summer has improved, and he's going through more of his progressions.
And Boykin with a great play fake. And he got drilled by Demarius Travis at the 27-yard line. But a good gain, 6 yards on first down.
And Minnesota understands that Trevon Boykin and this offense are going to make plays. They're going to make plays in the passing game and running game. When he has the football, when two is running with the football, Minnesota's main goal is to hit him and make them feel it.
They're going to rotate backs. Aaron Green in the backfield, and he gets the carry. Right at the first down marker, he's tackled by Jack Lynn. TCU wasn't in third down a ton last year, but when they were, seemingly always was third and short. Any team's going to struggle third and seven plus, but Boykin especially last year did. This will be third down and inches. Green and Boykin in the backfield. Now Green leaving, so an empty set. Boykin throwing, and the catch is made. A first down near the 40-yard line by Juwan Story, a transfer from Florida.
And this is going to be the matchup that Doug Meacham tries to find. Jalen Myrick, a year ago, struggled against Josh Dotson. Two fades for touchdowns. This Minnesota secondary is one of the most experienced and excellent secondaries in all of college football. Eric Murray is one of the best corners in college football. And Brian Body Calhoun. But that's not who they're going to throw the ball on. They're going to throw it on Myrick.
Another pass play, and Boykin with a long throw to Lissenby, pulled in, being defended by Eric Murray, close to a first down, just shy of midfield. Beck Patterson, to your point about the secondary, said that Murray was the best corner they played against last year. Second down on a yard, and a penalty flag down. First infraction of the night.
A false start by number 81 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty And it's still third down.
That's on Story. Got a Big 12 officiating crew. Our replay crew is from the Big 10.
We talked about this secondary. You add in Demaryius Travis, Antonio Johnson as well. Take a look at those games played. 143 combined games played. They felt like they played TCU pretty good last year in that game. The five turnovers was the difference, but defensively, Tracy Clays felt like they were not overmatched athletically.
Boyk into the air on second down and six, and wide open in the middle of the field is Emmanuel Porter. A first down to the Minnesota 46-yard line.
We have not mentioned Deontay Gray, who's out of this game with a knee injury. Cameron Echols Looper transfers. Emmanuel Porter is a name to remember for TCU as a third wideout.
Boykin with a fade that's overthrown. One of many that we'll see tonight. Those taller receivers, good job by Eric Murray defending Emmanuel Porter, the intended receiver, second down.
I had a chance to go to practice last week and watch Porter work. He is tireless. He understands that the stars of this offense are Dotson and Lissenby right now, but Porter is coming. He is the next wave as a true sophomore, 6'4", 210 pounds, and you know, they lost David Porter as well from a year ago, so they need a third option just for games like this with teams that have two good corners, and he's already stepping up.
Play 10 of the drive coming up for TCU. Boykin off play action, has room to run. Boykin breaks a tackle, has the first down to the 34. A 13-yard run. Boykin rushed for over 700 yards last year.
It's just unfair when he gets on the second level. Jack Lynn had good spacing, but not able to get him on the ground.
Little half roll, and Boykin threw it behind the intended receiver. Buck Jones could not come up with it. Second down.
Guys, to show you the leadership of Javon Boykin, Doug Beecham, the offensive coordinator, was screaming down the sideline to get a timeout called before that last scramble. But when you watch Boykin, he went in the huddle. He knew he didn't have the complete call, so he made the call on his own. And again, his legs making things happen when the ideal read's not there. That's the value of his athleticism.
Second year from Meacham and Sonny Cumbie as co-coordinators, bringing in the air raid system, which worked beautifully last year. All the players bought in, led to a 12-win season. Out on the flat it goes to Kevontae Turpin. Demaryius Travis and Eric Murray over there defensively. So now they're in third medium. See how Boykin handles this, their first challenge offensively of the game.
It's a situation where Javon Boykin loves his security blanket, Ty Slanina. He's in the slot. Great route runner. He's right here. Middle of the field is a great place to attack in third and medium.
Third and seven officially. Boykin fakes one way, trying to set up the screen. He's in trouble and slammed down at the 36-yard line. Steven Richardson there first for the Gophers. Now they're out of field goal range, you would think, from here.
Great job of running. Watch. You're going to try to throw the screen down here. Great job by this defensive line. Recognizing screen. That's a true freshman in Julian Huff, number 20. You don't expect a true freshman to read that screen like that. Great coaching by Tracy Clays. And then the defensive line converging, not allowing Travon Boykin to get a first down.
And I'm surprised here that they're going to try the field goal this early in the game. This is a 53-yard attempt. Now Oberkrohm has the leg to do it. We got a timeout. Oberkrohm made a 47-yarder last year and a 56-yarder two seasons ago. We'll see if we have a different decision for Gary Patterson when we come back. Jaden Oberkrohm, number one among active kickers in the country and made field goals, as we mentioned, a 56-yarder 2 years ago. But early in the game, this is surprising, given that Minnesota has not shown the ability, at least last year, to be able to move the football 80 yards every time. And this one is good. Sneaks in for the game's first points. And after a 13-play drive, TCU, thanks to Jaden Overcrome, his 59th career made field goal, drills it from 53.
You get to get the jitters out. 13 plays, gave up some yards, but anytime you keep TCU's offense out of the end zone, I would consider that a win.
Boykin was 5 of 7 for 37 yards passing and rushed for 20 yards on that drive. 53-yard field goal, and he still has something left for the kickoff. It'll come out to the 25 for Minnesota. Let's check him with Tom Luganville.
Well, fellas, a year ago in this matchup, it was all about self-inflicted wounds for Minnesota. Turnovers, horrendous field position, which immediately led to points for TCU. We've already seen with Minnesota's first drive, they may not have come away from points, but they got themselves in a position where they could punt the ball away and force TCU to play the long field. And in doing so, they were able to hold TCU to a field goal. You manufacture a couple of explosive plays, you don't just allow the easy one for TCU, and all of a sudden in the fourth quarter, you're in this ball game if you're Minnesota.
One of the questions is, can they get explosive plays in the passing game for Mitch Leidner? Leidner was 3 of 4, 16 yards on the first possession. And TCU not fooled there as Leidner is pushed back, no gain. Take a look at our impact players on D.
Yeah, a couple of guys on defense, Dave. Mike Freeze, Sammy Douglas, trying to replace Paul Dawson, Marcus Mallett, Sam Carter. They lost the heart and soul of this defense, TCU did. Mike Freeze is a true freshman who was hurt all of his senior year of high school, so he's playing his first game since his junior year of high school, and to do it in this stage is asking a lot.
Leidner hit from behind, and it's scooped up by Caraway of TCU. It's ruled a fumble on the field. Terrell Lathan chopped it out, and TCU recovers at the 15-yard line.
Terrell Lathan went right around the left tackle, Ben Lauer. Great pass rush move. Here he is. He gets up and under. Ben Lauer has been struggling in camp. He had knee surgery in camp, just not able to kick out. Josh Campion, their left tackle from a year ago, was hurt, not playing in this game because of a concussion. And Lauer has moved to left tackle, and Terrell Lathan just took advantage.
And this is what happened to Minnesota last year. TCU kept starting in plus territory. Got 30 first half points. First down at the 15-yard line. Green to the 11. Stood up there by Jack Lynn. Gained of 4 yards for Green, who rushed for almost 1,000 yards. Played in the Big Ten a few years ago. Transferred from Nebraska.
They have a stable that they love. Kyle Hicks is another player, 24, Travorce Johnson, you see in the game now. He's their load back in short yardage situation. They love to give him the football.
Sean Nixon back there as well. He's a freshman, missed last season with an injury. Boykin throws, and it's going to be a touchdown. A walk-in score for Josh Dotson.
Great design of this play. It's a curl and a flat and then a corner route. They're just trying to clear the field for Josh Dotson. This is an easy read, pitch and catch. If you're Brian Body Calhoun, you have got to be in tighter coverage. It's just too far off right there. Walk-in touchdown without even being touched.
11 touchdown catches last year for Dotson. 2 in the first half of the Minnesota game. Point after from Overcrome makes it 10-0. Well, TCU last year, one of the best teams in the country at taking the ball away. 26 consecutive games now with a takeaway, the longest streak in the country, and Boykin turns the turnover. 10-0, Horned Frogs. And Myrick going to bring it out, the first return for Minnesota. And Myrick undercut down at the 19-yard line.
Hey, let's go back and look at the touchdown. I want you to take a look. This is Eric Murray down here. He's 6 feet tall. They're very confident in him playing press man-to-man coverage. Here's Body Calhoun and Dotson. Now, Body Calhoun's only 5'11", and Dotson is 6'3". I think that is what prevented him from playing press coverage. He's worried about the fade route, but he plays so far off. Great adjustment by TCU not to throw the fade, just throw it underneath, make a miss, and get in the end zone. Dotson presents so many problems because of his length and his ability to go up and get the football.
Now Leidner going to work here on first down. Eric Carter wrapped up at the 24-yard line by Denzel Johnson. A 4-yard gain on first down.
Minnesota, you got to get something going here. You got to possess the football. You had a negative play, sack, fumble, and gave up a touchdown. Mitch Leidner, you can't get it all back in one play. He's been very emotional now. You see as Leidner comes out and Strebler's in, the backup quarterback. In these cases, it's a lot of heavy run.
And Strebler taking off here. They get sandwiched to the 26, just a 2-yard pickup. Ty Summers on the tackle.
They'll do that from time to time. Matt Linegrover, their offensive coordinator, likes to get Strebler in the game. He's an athlete. Says he makes plays with the ball in his hand. He's not a thrower from the quarterback position, but he is dynamic running the football. They want to get him 8 or 10 touches throughout the game.
At least it puts Minnesota in a chance where they can convert here, 3rd down and 3. They've got to be in 3rd down and short. Got a stoppage of play and a Minnesota timeout. Play clock was at 9.
30-second timeout.
Back in a moment with a 3rd and 3 for Minnesota. Mitch Leidner grew up 30 minutes from the Minnesota campus. Younger brother is a walk-on center. Trying to keep the chains moving here and keep that TCU offense on the sideline. A 3rd and 3 for the Gophers from their 27. Hand off to Williams, and he is going to come up just short. Knocked down at the 29. Ty Summers with a hit, 4th and 1.
Great job by that TCU linebacking core. You mentioned Ty Summers. He's going to rotate in. Mike Freeze was in there. Great job of reading their keys and getting a hit on the running back and bringing up a 4th down punt. Nobody knew how these linebackers were going to respond. I was at practice a week ago, and Gary Patterson is as animated as I've ever seen him coaching those linebackers, and he's got to be happy with the way they played here in the first quarter.
And again, no Davion Pearson, no James McFarland, two of their most talented defensive linemen. Both out with injury. McFarland here. Pearson did not make the trip. Mortel, an excellent punter, gets off a good one. Turpin slips a tackle. And then brought down at the 28-yard line. TCU's offense back on the field. 15th season for Gary Patterson. This might be his best team. That's saying something. In 2010, they were undefeated, 13-0 with Andy Dalton at quarterback. And they beat Wisconsin in the Rose Bowl.
Well, we know Gary Patterson's always been involved on the defensive side. But watching him last week, like I said, he's been more involved than I'd ever seen, especially with Mike Freeze, a true freshman at linebacker. He knows the weighty expectations of being the number 2 ranked team in the country and his defense so young.
Boykin on first down. Everybody covered. And now Boykin throws, and it's caught by Dotson for a 1st down. And apparently he was not over the line.
Always
on the tackle.
You always have to stick to your man. We were talking about that with Minnesota defensively. It's almost you can't come off against Boykin because he's going to throw the ball down the field on your man that you came off of. So it's one of the most, if not the most difficult player in all of college football to defend.
1st down to the 40-yard line. After that 13-yard pickup, Boykin going the other way. Excellent play by Demarius. Well, was the ball down? They're going to rule that forward progress was stopped at the 40-yard line. Ace Rogers in coverage that time on Desmond White. Made an excellent play to bring down the receiver for no gain.
Yeah, great read by Ace Rogers. He's going to throw him down. Does that ball come out? It does come out before the elbow was down. The question is, was his right knee down?
Well, and they ruled forward progress was stopped at the 40-yard line.
Boy,
They snap it. Boykin throwing a deep ball. And it's incomplete. Because forward progress was ruled to have stopped, it is not a reviewable play, and that's why the officials did not stop action.
You go back, he's at the 40-yard line, then he's at the 38, 37. I don't know.
I don't think forward progress was stopped.
I wouldn't have stopped forward progress there. The rule, the officials try not to have that forward progress too soon, just in that case if the ball comes out.
So it's third down and 10. TCU left out of the college football playoff a year ago. A national title contender perhaps this year as Boykin airs it out. Overthrown. Going for Dotson. And a flag thrown in late. Penalty marker thrown at the 45-yard line of TCU.
Well, that's Joey Hunt, the center, who was more than 3 yards downfield when that ball came out. I think he thought that Trevon Boykin was going to run, so he went downfield to block. And then the pass was thrown.
There is no foul for an eligible receiver downfield. It's fourth down.
So TCU will punt the football, no flag. 2:15 remaining in the first, and TCU on top 10-0.
Good stop by this Minnesota defense. You know, they've been put in a bad spot early in this game. Get a stop when they needed it most.
Ethan Perry had 12 punts last year, more than 50 yards. He'll boot it deep to Craig James. And it's a low liner. And it takes a TCU bounce out near the 10. He'll spot it at the 11 for Minnesota. Let's take a look at this week's college football rankings brought to you by Goodyear, the AP Top 10. Top-ranked Ohio State at Virginia Tech Monday night on ESPN. Alabama, Wisconsin on ABC Saturday. Baylor, like TCU, left out of the playoffs last year at SMU tomorrow night on ESPN.
So which one of those, partner, which one of those top 10 teams should be on upset alert?
Well, I think Alabama.
Yeah.
Against Wisconsin. Joel Staube has been up and down. But we've seen him play well at times.
Absolutely.
In the Wisconsin games we've done. They have a good back in Corey Clement. Roderick Williams gets the carry, picks up two.
You know, a lot of people had Arizona State way up there, too, and I think they're going to have their hands full with Texas A&M. That's going to be a great ball game. It's one I'm looking forward to the most.
What do you think about that Alabama-Wisconsin matchup?
Well, there's so many questions for Alabama, but, you know, we've learned that there's been questions at the quarterback position before, and they've overcome it. But I don't know. In this case, it's a little bit different than it was a year ago with Sims and Coker. I think they've got more questions at that position than they've ever had.
Second down and 8 for Minnesota. Leidner to the air. Through the hands of May. Incomplete. Nick Orr in coverage. So it's third down and 8.
These are the plays you got to make. From quarterback to receiver. AJ May on a simple slant to drag slant. Good route. Ball's high. Ball's high. And it goes through your hands. Both guys are responsible for that. It's got to be a better throw. If that ball is in his face mask, he might run for another 10, 15 yards. But those are the plays and the details that Minnesota offensively hasn't had in the past. And if they're going to take that next step, they need to be able to convert.
Now if you're TCU, you know it's coming. Leidner in trouble, gets hit as he throws. And that may have forced an errant pass. May, the intended receiver. Lathan, who had the forced fumble, getting around Ben Lauer earlier. Got pressure that time also.
Yeah, and Matt Lauer is going to need to get some help. Here he is right here. He's just coming. Same rush as we saw, sack fumble. Matt Limegrover might want to think about chipping a back out, putting a tight end next to Lauer. If you know that you are thin at the tackle position and your guy has just come off of surgery, knee surgery, help him out. Don't put him on an island like that because bad things are going to happen.
Now Mortel punting out of his own end zone on 4th and 8. And running up to get it is Turpin. He signaled for a fair catch and a penalty flag down. You can't take off after you signaled, or it's an infraction against TCU. And what did Gary Patterson tell us?
Well, I was asking Coach Patterson. Kevontae Turpin's a true freshman.
By number 25 of the receiving team. He gave a fair catch signal and then advanced the ball.
Gary Patterson says, you know, Kevontae doesn't know what he doesn't know. He said, if he's coming forward, he's gonna signal for a fair catch. If he stays, right now he's telling him, if you stay still, you have a chance to return it. But anytime you're coming forward, I want you to fair catch it. So there he goes. And he just says, well, maybe they didn't see it.
Well, you're really supposed to have your hand up waving it for it to be a valid fair catch. I wonder if he was trying to tell guys to get out of the way. There was a line drive and he was in traffic.
Yep.
But TCU starts in plus territory at the Minnesota 49-yard line. Turpin stays in the game. So the coach showing confidence in Turpin. A lot of green, and Turpin is inside the 35. A 16-yard run for 150-pound back in Kevontae Turpin.
Well, Gary Patterson, he only coaches the guys hard that he knows can really play. And he knows Kevontae Turpin is going to contribute on this offense and in special teams a lot this year. So he's fast, shifty, he's got a different gear. And that's saying something on offense with guys like Colby Lissenby.
Play clock is down to 5. Option, Boykin keeping inside the 30. And slammed down at the 25 by Ace Rogers, a couple of yards short of a first down.
Dave, Brian, you hear him talk about Turpin. He's undersized, not very big, but he can flat out run. He's got great quickness. That just epitomizes their entire recruiting structure at TCU. They're not worried about finished products or college-ready guys. They're ready about guys that fit their program, fit their mold. They'll put them in the weight room and feed them. The rest, as you can see with Turpin, is pretty special.
They got to feed him a lot. He's at 152. But he's got some wheel. Knocked down at the line of scrimmage by Antonio Johnson. So when we start the second quarter, a third down and 2 for TCU. The Horned Frogs had a long drive that stalled, and then Overcrone nailed a 53-yard field goal. Their touchdown came after a Minnesota turnover. And it's 10-0, number 2 TCU leading on the road after a quarter. TCU in third and long. When TCU's been in third and 6 or more, they're 0 for 2. Third and 5 or less, 2 for 2. And this is a third and 2 at the Minnesota 25. Boykin, a touchdown pass in the first quarter. He'll hand it off to Green, who's got the first down. He stumbled, otherwise he might have gotten more, but still picked up 5 to move the sticks.
Yeah, Minnesota tried to bring an internal pressure with Pope, the linebacker, and they just guessed wrong, and they got creased. Sometimes you got to shoot your gun on defense and take a chance to get a negative play, and it just came up on the wrong end for Minnesota.
Fresh set of downs from the red zone now. Boyk into the air. Going to Dotson. Nice play by Murray. In single coverage on Dotson, drags him down after a 4-yard pickup.
This is one of those points, you know, every game has a bunch of points, an inflection point where the momentum can really get out of hand. And if Minnesota can't keep TCU out of the end zone, and they go down 17-0 early in the second quarter, it's kind of like it was a year ago when they were down 24-0. It's hard to come back from.
Nixon gets the call on 2nd and 6. He stopped at the 13 by Antonio Johnson. Another 3rd and short for TCU. Jaden Overcombe made a 53-yard field goal. Trevon Boykin with a touchdown pass. On a hot, humid night here in Minneapolis, Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville. TCU ranked number 2 in the country after getting left out of the first college football playoff last year. They trounced Ole Miss in the Peach Bowl, won 12 games, returned 10 starters on offense, lost most everybody on defense, including a couple of guys hurt tonight. But so far, they haven't surrendered any points, and they're looking to add to a 10-0 lead right now. Green, nowhere to go. Finds a running lane and fumbled the ball. And Murray was there for Minnesota, and the Gophers have it. Antonio Johnson with the recovery.
I think that was Eric Murray who came up from his corner position and forced that fumble and then recovered it. Great corners don't just make plays in a passing game. They come up and they are physical against the rush, and Eric Murray can do all of it. Talked about that inflection point, yes, that momentum point, and you need your senior leaders. You need your guys that are your best players to make plays when the game is on the line. And Eric Murray got up in front of the team yesterday at practice and talked about that, talked about making plays and leaving nothing on the field, and he's backing it up with his play.
You and I were getting the feeling up here that if it's 17-0 ball game, Minnesota had to have that. The Gophers got it, and now they take over at their 13-yard line. Rodney Smith is the running back. Straight ahead to about the 15-yard line. They roll him down. True freshman Mike Freeze, their middle linebacker, made the hit. Smith is a redshirt freshman. We'll get some carries this year. Roderick Williams is their featured back. Second and 8.
Well, and Mike Freeze continues with every single snap that he takes. He's getting more and more comfortable. He has the talent. 6'3", 220 pounds. He's a converted safety, so we know he can run. He's faster than Paul Dawson. Problem is that, you know, he's playing the game in his head right now, so he's probably not playing as fast as he could, but certainly holding his own.
Off play action, Leidner on second down, going deep and overthrew it. Going into double coverage, trying for true freshman Rashad Still.
Brian, you talked about being at TCU's practice and how Gary Patterson was coaching these linebackers hard. Really, in particular, coaching the true freshman Mike Freeze hard. But as you watched him on the sideline, he's coaching him in an entirely different manner. More calm, a little bit more, almost as if he's caring about how he feels coming off of each series. He's doing a really nice job of handling young players' emotions. Right now, Mike Freeze is a smart and heady player on this field, and the game is not too big for him, certainly not overwhelmed, and not overwhelmed at the point of attack either.
Well, and Gary Patterson knows exactly how to coach these guys. He's hard on them in practice, and in the game, he's supportive, and that's exactly what you want to do to get the best out of them.
Delay a game here on Minnesota, unless Jerry Gill called timeout.
By number 7 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still 3rd down.
3rd and 8 is difficult enough for Minnesota's offense. Now it's 3rd and 13.
How many times do we say it in these situations? You got to be smart. And you just got a little, you got to turn over a little bit of momentum. And you got to handle the position of quarterback. And a lot of that is being aware of the clock and not throwing the ball over in these situations.
They're just going to run the ball here on 3rd down and 13. And Smith gets a chunk of it back out to the 16-yard line. Fans don't like that, but hard to blame offensive coordinator Matt Leingrover in that situation. 4th down, and Minnesota will punt. They have an excellent punter. Mortel had 21 kicks and more than 50 yards last year. We'll try to boom one here. And again, you got a true freshman returning punts. He's already made one mistake in Kevontae Turpin.
If he catches it, look out, because he's special. Another guy that with every single rep and with every touch of the ball is going to continue to get confidence. And Gary Patterson doesn't have the luxury of bringing these guys along slowly. They got the talent. He's going to put them out there.
Turpin letting this one go, and it takes a Minnesota hop. That's exactly what they wanted there from Mortel. To about the 26, 10-0. Horned Frogs take over after a 59-yard punt. And Boykin hands it off to Trevoris Johnson for a gain of 4. You know, Gary Patterson and Jerry Kill go way back. They're very good friends. Kill was one of the groomsmen in Gary's wedding.
Good looking photo there.
Boykin taking off here. He gets leveled at the 31, only a 1-yard gain, so 3rd down coming up.
It's been fun to talk to these two guys and to get a window into the relationship between Gary Patterson and Jerry Kill. The utmost respect for each other. You know, Gary Patterson told me, he said, if there's any coach in college football that's more like me than Jerry Kill, I don't know who it is, because these two guys from Kansas, assistants on the Pittsburgh State staff, have a ton of respect for each other.
Boykin hit as he pitches it. Ball is on the ground, but scooped up by Nixon. And then he's brought down by Cody Polk. And Boykin a little shaken up. Took him some time to get off the ground. Minnesota forces a punt.
again, true freshman, Julian Huff. 5'11", 220 pounds, off the edge. Here he is. He's just going to come up the field. His responsibility is the quarterback and the quarterback only. He goes after Trevon Boykin and then finished up by Pope. Great defensive play on the option by Minnesota.
And a penalty marker down. Again, that shows you that the weapon that Peter Mortel is, the punter for Minnesota, right? You get that 59-yard kick, so you flip the field.
A false start by 81 of the offense. A 5-yard penalty, and it's still fourth down.
You get a 3-and-out, get some momentum, and now you're forcing Elliott Perry after that penalty to kick it from around his 10-yard line. Or Ethan Perry, excuse me.
Some sort of return in this situation would be huge.
Not a good kick. Out of bounds around the 40-yard line. So Minnesota with excellent starting field position. Down 10-0 here in the second quarter. Mitch Leidner and the Minnesota offense struggling after that first drive where they picked up 2 first downs. Nothing since, and only 33 yards of total offense. What has to change?
Yeah, I think they need to start getting the ball to their tight ends. Wozniak, you see there, number 80, big 6'10 tight end. Get some misdirection in the running game.
And here's a flea flicker. Creativity on first down. KJ May is there for the grab at the 25-yard line.
Looks like they're going to get up to the line of scrimmage maybe and go tempo. But great call by Matt Limegrover. Not a great throw. If that ball's out in front of May, it's a touchdown. Great job coming back and getting the football.
35-yard pass play. They go hurry up. Williams on the ground inside the 20. Got a handful on first down. Mike Tuu'u on the tackle. Minnesota won't huddle either here.
Sorry, Dad. I like spreading it out and giving the ball to Roderick Williams as a sledgehammer at 235 pounds in the middle of the field.
On second and 5. Williams again got a crease. Inside the 15 down to the 11. He got 8 yards, another first down, and here they go again.
Low to the ground, low to the ground with Roderick Williams. Now that you've run it 3 times, play action can have its effect.
They pound it with Williams, and he pushes the pile down to the 7-yard line. That 235-pound running back, Roderick Williams, replacing David Cobb, who rushed for a school record 1,600 yards last year. They're feeding him here in the red zone.
People forget he was a starting running back 2 years ago before Cobb and then got hurt, lost his job.
Williams again, and he fumbled the ball into the end zone. It's recovered by TCU and a touchback. The question is, was it recovered while he was out of bounds? Was it recovered in the end zone for TCU?
That possession
by Nick Orr
in the end zone. That's exactly right. Derek Kindred, the safety, came up and put a shoulder on the ball.
The ruling on the field is that the ball was fumbled in the field of play and recovered in the end zone by the defense. First down.
A huge mistake by Roderick Williams, fumbling the ball as he went skyward. And boy, hard to tell, was it kicked out?
No, it was the shoulder of Derek Kindred. He came, put a shoulder on it. There's the recovery there. That's Orr, number 18. The ball's definitely out. And that ball, there he is. He's got it in possession and a shoulder down. And the ruling on the field is that he is down in the end zone for a touchback. I think it's a good call.
I didn't hear him call me.
And Boykin keeping it on first down. Picks up only a couple. Let's bring in Doug Rhodes, our rules analyst, former ACC supervisor of officials. What'd you see, Doug?
Well, it was clearly a fumble. The ball came loose in the field of play. The only question is, was the recovering player in contact with the sideline? I think he wasn't, and that is a correct call.
A big mistake by Minnesota. Second and 8, Boykin. A broken tackle and then getting smashed to the ground is Sean Nixon, short of the marker at the 29. So third down and 1. Turnovers the story again today for Minnesota, just like last year as Boykin. There is a flag down. Was there movement? TCU may not have been set there. Penalty marker came in late after the snap.
Well, Trevon was trying to get the ball snapped before Minnesota got set, and I don't know that his guys were set.
A false start by number 7 of the offense. He never got set. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still third down.
It's Colby Listenby. So now it's third down and 6 instead of third and 1.
There he is. You know, sometimes you out-trick yourself, but now brings up a great opportunity for Minnesota in a 3rd and 6.5, 7-yard situation to get off the field immediately after a sudden change turnover.
TCU 3 of 7 on third down. That's because they've been in some third down in 6-plus situations like here. Boykin guns it, and Dotson can't hang on. Kunle Ayinde in coverage. Fourth down and a punt.
All of a sudden, Trevon Boykin doesn't look quite as comfortable in the pocket. Same route as they scored the touchdown on, but nice job there, Neek, by Ayinde, to come over and just get in the peripheral vision of Dotson. Incomplete pass.
Last punt by Perry wasn't good, neither is this one. And fair caught in traffic by Craig James at the 45-yard line. Minnesota couldn't make anything happen last drive after getting into the red zone. We'll see what happens when we come back. And the fumble by Roderick Williams inside the 5 on the last possession. Rodney Smith is in the game now at running back. May have been his turn anyway. They've been rotating the 2 backs throughout the game. Great starting field position. Leidner to throw on 1st and 10. Going deep, and it's incomplete. And man, Eric Carter had 2 TCU defenders defeated that time, but they could not make the connection.
That ball came out weird, because look at Derek Kindred. Derek Kindred tried to play the ball as well, and he misjudged it. And then right after that, Carter misjudged it. So a missed opportunity, that ball right through the hands of Carter.
And stumbling is Smith. The ball is on the ground again. They rule Smith down, though, at the 48. So a 3-yard gain. 3rd and 7 coming up here for Minnesota as we're inside 7 minutes to go in the half.
Dave, that was almost a touchdown there. If Smith was able to keep his feet, there was a huge hole. He just got tripped up as he tried to get through the line of scrimmage.
3rd and 6. Leidner, and this time May hangs on to it. A 1st down at the 43 of TCU.
Something to build on for Matt Leidner. There it is. 3rd down, big. You gotta be accurate. In that case, tight man-to-man coverage, small windows. He puts it a foot in front of the number for a 1st down.
Mitch Leidner now 6 of 11, 64 yards. As Rodney Smith carries and ran into a teammate, one of his offensive linemen, and gets about 3 on the play.
Couple new tackles, Dave. We talked about Ben Lauer at left tackle. In that knee surgery, they have put Piersick. They've moved him over from right tackle and put Foster Bush in at right tackle.
Another run play in a huge hole. Ankle tackle on Smith by Kenny Iloka. A 9-yard run to the 31, and now Minnesota speeding things up.
The offensive line starting to get to the second level. You see right there, Connor Mays, 55, gets on Ty Summers. If this offensive line can get to the second level, they can run the football.
Smith again. The biggest defensive lineman for TCU is Davion Pearson. He's their only 300-pounder, and he's out tonight with an injury. So a clear size advantage for Minnesota up front. Now they're hammering it between the tackles. Got 6 yards there. 2nd down and 4. Leidner with time. Incomplete. Intended for Melvin Holland, Nick Orr in coverage. 3rd down.
This is a route by a freshman. You know, as a true freshman, Holland.
Got to catch the ball, right? He was running with him and bumped him, but.
That's not exactly a spiral coming out of there, Coach. That's not the easiest ball to catch. That thing was going up and down.
Here comes pressure, and that forced another poor throw. Caraway got around the right tackle that time. And so now it is 4th down. What do you do? You got 3 points here.
Yeah, I think you need points. And as lopsided as the first quarter was, this is still a 10-point game. It could be a 3-point game But you got to get it to a one possession game right here before half.
Ryan Santoso, who was 12 of 18 last year, will attempt a 43 yarder to get Minnesota on the board. And the kick is good. Well, Minnesota finally on the board and within a score, 10-3 TCU. College football analysis. Reese Davis, your new host. Herbie Dez and Coach Corso are back Saturdays 9 a.m. We kick it off from Fort Worth, Alabama and Wisconsin on ABC Saturday night. Santoso kicking off. Listen B, one of the fastest guys in college football, a track All-American. But they had him pinned on that sideline and he could not make it past the 20-yard line. Ace Rogers down there for Minnesota. TCU's offense, last handful of drives, not been able to move the ball. What's Minnesota doing to keep the Horned Frogs in check offensively?
Well, I think it's a couple things. TCU was running the ball really effectively on the previous drives. They've gotten away from that and tried to throw the football. Dotson had an incomplete pass on a third down, and then they had an option play, which was very well defensed by Minnesota on the perimeter. So Minnesota's guys on defense have started to make some plays, and Julian Huff, the true freshman, is back in there, number 20. He's been an X factor so far in this game.
They're getting TCU also in third and long situations, and Boykin is 0 for 3 passing on third down. And a throw on first down. No, he won't. Runs out of play, pushed out by Campbell at the 26-yard line, a 7-yard run for Trevon Boykin, a senior, fifth-year player from Dallas, the reigning Big 12 Player of the Year. The only time a TCU player has won the Heisman, Davey O'Brien back in 1938. Boykin finished fourth in voting last year, was not invited to New York, though, and certainly one of the favorites going into the 2015 regular season. On second and three, quick toss there. Finds Dotson for a first down at the 35.
See the arm angle and delivery from Trevon Boykin. He's very creative in the pocket. One of the things I jumped out at me studying his film, he doesn't have to have his feet set all the time to throw the football. In a lot of cases, you'd say a quarterback, that's not a good thing, but he's such a great athlete that he can keep his body in position and deliver that football accurately without having his feet set on every single throw.
Boykin pulls it back, looking deep, one-on-one coverage down the field, incomplete. Emmanuel Porter could not come up with it. They targeted Jalen Myrick, and it's second down.
That's got to feel good for Jalen Myrick. He's the one that was beat two times for touchdowns in last year's game, and again, he's downfield. Great coverage, nice job of not putting his hands on the receiver. Very tempting. Could have been an easy pass interference call, but it's well played by Myrick.
The only touchdown in this game coming off a turnover inside Minnesota's 20. Green with a huge lane to midfield for 15 yards. Nobody in the middle of the defense that time for Minnesota.
Minnesota's moving a lot up front on defense. Take a look, they're slanting away. The guy gets up on the linebacker. There's just nowhere for Minnesota to get that guy on the ground.
Another good run by Green. Antonio Johnson gets him to the ground, but after 9 yards.
This is what TCU was doing so well in the first quarter, and now they're back to running the ball in between the tackles and forcing Minnesota to come up and tackle.
There's some movement by one of the up men, Dominic Mirka.
A false start by 84 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
Second and six after the flag.
He's right here.
He hadn't played a whole lot. He got a lot of snaps. on national TV at night on the road. And a little antsy, came up out of his stance.
You're saying I shouldn't have circled him right there?
I think everybody saw it anyway. I saw it from up here live.
Now that's saying something. You see.
Second and six. Out of an empty set. Boykin pumps and now lobs it into traffic. Intended for Desmond White. Ace Rogers in coverage. So here we go. Third and six plus. Boykin 0 for 3 passing in these situations. Chance for Minnesota to get the ball back. 3:21 on the clock in the half.
Mass substitutions for Minnesota defensively. They're going to take Devondre Campbell, their probably their best linebacker, and line him up in a rush position. Number 26.
Minnesota rushes four. Boykin has a man underneath. The first down grab made by Sean Nixon. First down at the Minnesota 38.
So many weapons, so many weapons. Have you heard of Sean Nixon? No, we haven't heard of Sean Nixon. He's a redshirt freshman, and not just the running back, but now they spread him out and throw the football to him. It's hard to defend.
Boykin to the air again, and it's Nixon again. He was injured in camp last year and missed the whole season.
You know, one of the things we don't talk a whole lot about with TCU's offense, they got such great players, and Lissom B and Dotson on the outside, but they work the inside of the field if you get a penalty, a stoppage here. But that opens up all of the middle of the field for Slanina.
Minnesota
Dixon,
calls their
guys.
Second timeout of the half.
Minnesota calls for time. TCU driving, leading by 7.
The College Football Playoff.
TCU left out last year, was ranked third in the penultimate College Football Playoff rankings, then left out, went to the Peach Bowl, a New Year's Six game and won, brings back most of its offense from a year ago. And on second and 5, it's Boykin getting the first down. Inside the 30, made it to the 26.
That was a great example. They love these wide splits. Dotson and Lissomby. Look how far they are towards the sideline. You get a wide view here. Dotson, he's almost on the sideline with the coaching staff. Lissomby at the top of the screen. When they do this, they love to run the ball. They're just trying to create running lanes.
Here it is. Green gets a block. Makes a great move inside. And then tracked down by Devondre Campbell. But after he gets the first down, all the way to the 14. A 12-yard run for Aaron Green.
Everyone on this offense is asked to do the dirty work. That time Nixon came in and got the crack block that sprung Green to the outside. This redshirt freshman coming in and getting the linebacker, and then a great move by Green.
Minnesota had a fumble inside the TCU 5. On the next possession, got a field goal. Trying to keep TCU off the board here to end the half, but a good drive by the Horned Frogs. They're inside the 15-yard line. And they fake the end around. Boykin inside the 10. Dives to the 9-yard line. A handful there for Boykin on the ground.
It's going to be a reoccurring theme for TCU throughout this year, Dave, I think, is how much to run Trevon Boykin. There's going to be times where he's back to pass and he just creates as an athlete. And those are the times that you want him to run the ball. But how many design quarterback lead draws, quarterback power, in between the tackle runs are you going to have with Trevon Boykin at 205 pounds? You're going to take a risk. It's got something that Gary Patterson's got away.
21 passes, 11 runs for Boykin so far. Second down and 5. Boykin, and his pass is nearly intercepted. It's hard to get it over that guy. You don't see a lot of 6'5", 6'6", linebackers, but Devondre Campbell, tall, but couldn't bring down the football.
Great read. He acted like he was going to rush. Great opportunity for a sudden change up situation, and Devondre Campbell normally makes that play, and it was only the green grass in front of him.
Although
I don't think he would have outrun Trevon Boykin probably.
Still another missed chance for Minnesota. And Boykin hit, and down he goes. De'Aaron Cochran. First time we've called his name. A loss on the play, and so TCU will have to settle for a field goal attempt.
They really wanted De'Aaron Cochran to be the leader this year. He's just going to come upfield. The reason he can take the quarterback is because he feels comfortable that his secondary is going to take the back. So that frees him up to take quarterback. Tackle for loss.
And so Jaden Oberkrom, who has made 59 field goals for his career, number one among active kickers, a 53-yard field goal for the first points of the season in the first quarter. And TCU going to call a timeout here with 28 seconds left.
I would have told you that this Minnesota defense would hold TCU to 10 points, maybe 13 after this in the first half of this game. You'd say that's a big win,
yeah,
right? A big win. They just need to get something on the offensive side, and they started to do that with some change of pace stuff and run the football. But this is a win in the first half, even though that this has been a lopsided game at times. I think Minnesota's got to feel confident going into halftime.
What about TCU, number two coming in preseason? Do they look like a top two team right now?
You know, the first game of the year is always kind of messy. There's always turnovers. There's always mistakes. You got a brand new defense for the most part. I think whatever it looks like in the first half, you live with it. And then you come out in the second half, I think TCU will make some adjustments and probably play a lot better.
Oberkrom with a 29-yard attempt, and now Minnesota will call the timeout. A lot of gamesmanship for a 29-yard field goal, but these guys have been going at it all offseason. Again, these are great friends, and you know, a lot of coaches have their guys they like to call and bring in and talk defense or talk offense with, and Kill and Patterson, they normally do that, but the last 2 years, because they played each other, they haven't. And when Minnesota had its spring game, he was watching it, and Patterson called Kill and said, who are all these guys that are on the field? But Minnesota didn't play any of its starters in the spring game. he was going to watch it.
He thought Jerry Kill was trying to fool him, but Jerry was just trying to keep his guys healthy.
They don't have to put the depth charts out for the first game until 2 days before. Oberkrom's kick hits the upright, and it's no good. The freeze worked.
Gamesmanship works. Don't tell Jerry Kill. He will not surrender an inch. Any advantage that he can get, he's going to take it. It looked like Oberkrom, looked like the hold was a little bit squirrely there. It didn't get the laces out. Sometimes that can affect the kicker. Just hooked it.
Makes a 53-yarder, misses a 29-yarder. And Jerry Kill's like, man, finally we get a break in this game tonight. And Minnesota content. Going to halftime now. Land Rover halftime report coming up with John Saunders and Mark May.
Mayday looking good there. He's going to talk about run the ball. Minnesota, run the ball.
Also going to talk about the new coach at Michigan and the Battle of the Carolinas. That's coming up on the Land Rover halftime report. John Saunders and Mark May. So TCU with a missed field goal at the end of the half, and then Minnesota with a fumble inside the TCU 5, as it looked like Roderick Williams was going to go in to score. TCU turned it over inside the 15 and then had a missed field goal from 29 yards away to end the half. Listen be the return man. He runs it out, and he's out to the 20-yard line. Let's bring in Tom Luganville.
Well, Brian, to add to your comments in relationship to this offense and Trevon Boykin, you take a look at the pass chart here. No completions over 15 yards. Now, I'm going to take that another level. There's been only a couple of attempts that have been between the 5-yard and the 15-yard mark. Everything's underneath 5 to 8 yards. So when you're playing great defense and you're tackling, you're keeping the ball in front of you, you put so much pressure on that offense, takes them out of rhythm, and they've limited the run game. Keep those explosive plays away, and Minnesota's got a chance.
They got TCU in third and long a lot in that first half. That's what you have to do to have a shot. First down on the 24-yard line. And they get a chunk. Aaron Green brought down by Hank Hepe.
As good as Minnesota has played defensively, we know that one false assignment, one missed tackle, this offense can get on a roll and get explosive in a hurry. They have got to play all 60 minutes of this game.
TCU was fifth in total offense, number two in scoring behind Baylor last year. Basically everybody back in offense. Boykin gets drilled low, and he still completes the pass for a first down to Desmond White. It was Julian Huff again that hit the quarterback.
Well, Julian Huff's only 5'11", 220 pounds. He goes right under the left tackle. That's Vitae. Vitae's 6'6", 315 pounds. And Huff just had leverage and went right under it.
Boykin with a ton of time. Deep pass is pulled in by White. And a touchdown saving tackle by Boddy Calhoun. But it's a big play inside the 40.
And here's the frozen rope. We've seen this time and time again. When you give him time, a confident passer, Dez White is shifting with speed. Those are the kinds of plays that kill you.
Green on the run after a 26-yard pass play, about seven on the ground. Up on the stop.
But what's consistent? What's consistent with Trevon Boykin? When he has time and space in the pocket, he is deadly. When you get pressure in his face, you hit him, he's not as accurate. So that's the biggest difference with this TCU offense. And there's been a million defenses that have tried to get to Trevon Boykin, but the problem is you're in man coverage on the back end.
He gets it out so quickly. Second and five, play action. Boykin in trouble and showed some arm strength there. A sliding catch by Dotson. He'll come up short of the first down. They still get positive yardage. What a heck of a play by Boykin there.
He doesn't give up on any play. He's such a great athlete. He thinks he can make every throw and make every guy miss, and it's hard to argue with that.
Ekpe had pressure that time, so it's a third down and a yard. It's Green. Easily gets the first down inside the 25-yard line.
One of the best things TCU's done in this game is run between the tackles. It has a lot to do with those four senior offensive linemen up front moving the line of scrimmage.
Green again. Gain of five. Now they're getting chunks on the ground.
We don't talk a lot about Joey Hunt, their senior center, number 55. He's one of the best in all of college football. He makes all the calls up front, gets the run game organized, protections in the passing game. He's been outstanding so far in this game, getting to the second level on linebacker.
You made the point during the week that their offensive line is the most underrated part of their team as Boykin throws it away. Trying to hit Nixon, but there was pressure in the backfield. There's Julian Huff back there again, Ekpe as well. So you got a third and five for TCU.
Well, and this is the area of the field where, you know, getting a pass rush, Julian Huff, there he is, off the edge against Vitae. Take a look at the size difference right here. 6'6 against 5'11. One's a senior, one's a freshman. It doesn't get any bigger than that. See if he can get to the quarterback.
Third and five. Boykin has the first down and has a touchdown. Trevon Boykin with a 19-yard run.
Great play call by Doug Meacham. Realizing he's having trouble protecting his quarterback. He's getting hit. Let's just option away from Huff. Get a block by Dotson, a missed tackle by Murray. You get number two on the edge in grass, and he's going to make you pay.
Their best drive of the game by far. Their only other touchdown came on a turnover by Minnesota inside its own 20-yard line. A nine-play, 76-yard drive. And the point after makes it 17-3, TCU.
Get the feeling with TCU, it's only a matter of time. There's so much talent on this offense, you can't suppress them for 60 minutes. They're making them pay now. I miss my old partner. We just do college football Thursday nights. Mayday is down on the field now, and Van Pelt and I missed that, but that's going to be fun to watch Van Pelt with the Sports Center.
And a kickoff will result in a touchback. Minnesota will start on its 25.
All right, Dave, we talked about the big uglies up front. We talked about Joey Hunt. Let's take a look on that touchdown run. Give some credit to the big guys. He's going to come up on the second level, gets a block on the Mike linebacker. Look what that does for Trevon Boykin. It seals off. Now, in the second level, there's Eric Murray. That's Eric Murray's play to make. And if you don't make it on the outside, it's a touchdown. Great blocking up front and a missed tackle. That's what Minnesota avoided in the first half. And unfortunately, it came back to bite him on the first drive.
And Boykin responsible for 42 touchdowns a year ago, two tonight, one through the air, one on the ground. And now Minnesota has scored just 3 points in the first half, finds itself down 14, and Leidner to throw. He's in trouble, but keeps his feet and picks up a good chunk, about six on first down, spring and top.
No, the way this game is going now, this offense wants to be hurry up. They'd like to be hurry up all the time, as you see right here. But they can't do it each and every snap because they're so banged up in the offensive line. And that's coming directly from Jerry Kill. They'd go no huddle the rest of this game if they were healthy up front.
Here's Williams, and he is drilled. Big hit by Ty Summers. Terrell Lathan there as well. Well, they do have Persigan at left tackle. So Lauer, who's been struggling with that knee, is out. So they've got the guys up front that are at least healthy. Josh Campion out tonight due to a concussion. He had started the last 39 games for Minnesota. Third down and four. There's a flag down on the backfield. Leidner's pass is incomplete, intended for Eric Carter. He wanted pass interference for Anthony Tejada on the coverage for TCU. See what the penalty marker is for in the backfield.
A chop block by number 79 and 39 of the offense. The penalty is declined. It's fourth down.
Yeah, that's Persig right here. These two guys, Roderick Williams, Persig. Persig is engaged, and you go low, and that's the definition of a chop block. And this is the danger. This is the danger of Minnesota going no huddle, is they come out after giving up a long touchdown drive, and they go three and out. They can't get a first down, and they're going to punt the ball back with their defense tired, and that's... that's the give and take when you go no huddle.
Your defense is gassed after you're on the field, and TCU finally got a big play offensively with that Boykin run. And Mortel, normally very good, but that was not a good punt. And so TCU is going to start near its 30-yard line. 17-3, Horned Frogs early in the third. Complaint, I guess, on first down. Here's Sean Nixon breaking a tackle and then wrapped up by Murray near the first down at the 37-yard line. Trevon Boykin, a touchdown pass, a touchdown run, thrown for 142 yards in this game. Here's Nixon again. You talked about their depth, and Nixon getting a lot of touches in this game. Redshirt freshman from Austin.
They'll just cycle them in. They've got so much speed in recruiting, and Nixon is one of them. Dez White, another. Cavante Turpin. You're going to see a lot of those guys.
Boykin, big hole again. And Boykin gets to the 44-yard line. Minnesota needs a negative play at some point or a turnover. Got the takeaway near the end of the first half.
Well, we talk about pace. We talk about pace and how it affects defensive linemen in particular, and you're starting to see that these defensive linemen are gassed.
Boykin going downtown. And what a beautiful catch by Lissenby inside the 10. My goodness, what a grab. He had Jalen Myrick all over him, had to adjust to the ball, and made the grab for 37 yards.
Lissenby is one of those receivers. See if he gets that ball. Looked like it may have touched the ground.
But TCU got up there and snapped the ball.
I think that was an incomplete pass, and getting up and snapping that football, they avoided. Watch the nose of the ball.
Yeah, that thing was not possessed.
No.
There's a flag down because TCU wasn't set. If Jerry Kill doesn't call timeout to challenge, or if the official, the replay official, doesn't signal to Cooper Castleberry, the referee, that they want to look at it, TCU's going to get up there and try to snap it, which they did.
And there you can see a good shot of it, the ball touching the ground.
Which it can do as long as you possess it, but it moved.
Prior to the snap, Minnesota called their first timeout.
So they did. They were able to call the timeout to challenge the ruling on the field.
Well, that's heads up there, too, by Jerry Kill, because that was close. I mean, TCU was up on the line of scrimmage when they snapped that football. Let's take another look at this. Like you said, that ball is on the back of his hand. You can see that he's not controlling that ball.
So let's bring in Doug Rhodes, our rules analyst, former ACC supervisor of officials, who is here with us in the booth.
Yeah, that's going to have to be incomplete. A catch is a process. Possess the ball, control the ball, and if going to the ground, maintain control of the ball. And in this case here, he doesn't complete that process. The ball is loose at the very end, touches the ground.
That was a heck of an effort, though.
Oh, gosh.
Man. I mean, to contort your body like that, just watch and listen to me over the last year and a little bit in practice. He works on that a lot in practice, and going over his back shoulder, twisting his body in the air to make those acrobatic catches, and almost had it.
The ruling on the field was a catch. The previous play is under further review.
Because of the timeout. Now, they didn't announce that Jerry Kill is challenging it. But when you call timeout, you're allowed a challenge. If you win the challenge, you keep it. If the ruling on the field is overturned, he'll keep that challenge. Now, Lissenby has had a knack for making the incredible catch and sometimes dropping the routine. That was a pretty good throw by Boykin, too, huh?
First time they've really attacked down the field, and again, that was on Myrick.
You made the point, Brian. You think that Trevon Boykin could be better this year. In what regard? Where do you see the evolution of his game?
You know, I think in talking with Sonny Cumbie, his quarterback coach, last night, you know, he said there were really two areas. He wanted him to value the ball a little bit more. Last year, he felt like there were times where he didn't value the football, specifically in games like against Kansas, West Virginia, Texas. He's got to value the ball. And he was worried about that because the more experienced quarterback sometimes will take more chances because they're more confident. So that was number one for Coach Cumbie. And then number two was being able to know the offense a little bit more, be able to take more control of some of the checks in the offense, attacking grass. That's what they call it at TCU, is getting the ball in space, attack grass, and allowing Trevon Boykin in pre-snap and post-snap situations to make those checks and reads. And he felt like in the offseason they worked on that, and he's gotten a lot better.
He's got more passing yards this half, 98, than he had on the first half, 94. Now, they've got to look here, assuming this is reversed and it's incomplete. They've got to figure out, okay, how much time's on the clock? Where do we go back to spot the ball? What down is it? There's no doubt that this guy's going to be, if TCU, with 10 starters back on offense, is as good as it was last year, he's going to be in the Heisman conversation at the end of the year, and TCU will be in the playoff conversation. They have, after this, an easy non-league schedule, and then when they get into Big 12 play, they have to go to Kansas State, Oklahoma State. Their final two league games are at Oklahoma, home against Baylor, Friday of Thanksgiving weekend.
That last month of the season, brutal. On the road for those two games, Stillwater and Norman, and then that big matchup everybody wants to see from Baylor.
After further review, the receiver did not maintain control. It's going to be third down. Minnesota is not charged with a timeout.
So he wins the challenge. He gets to keep that challenge. And that may have saved the game for Minnesota. TCU's got a third down and long now. They've got to get the stick set correctly. And a huge down, maybe the play, third and four. But maybe the play of the game here for Minnesota defensively.
And they've had a lot of success defending the pass in these third down situations. Where they've struggled is defending the run, and specifically Trevon Boykin. So I expect Tracy Clay, as a defensive coordinator, to be keen on number two, running with the football.
He's got 72 rushing yards. Had a 19-yard scamper for a touchdown in the last TCU possession. sellout crowd here at TCF Bank Stadium, the first in two decades at a Minnesota home game. Used to play their games at the Metrodome before moving here almost 10 years ago. Third and four for TCU. And Boykin will throw. Steps up to the sideline. Dotson dives, and he's got it. A first down catch at the 30-yard line by Josh Dotson.
All-out blitz pressure on Trevon Boykin. He extends the play as he does so many times. Look at that effort by Dotson. Two of these receivers, Lissenby and Dotson, that's rare kind of effort and ability to change their body like that in the air.
The previous play is under further review.
So this is from the booth they're going to look at this. But, again, that angle looked like he clearly caught it. How about Boykin? This is a couple times now we've seen tremendous arm strength on the road.
Again, that's great concentration by Dotson.
Did it hit the ground? Did he possess it?
That's a catch. That's a great catch. Ball doesn't touch the ground. In his chest, it's controlled to the ground. It's a great catch.
Yeah.
And again, I thought Minnesota brought all-out pressure on this play. They had perfect play called, and they just can't get Trevon Boykin on the ground. He extends the play, and then with his athleticism, he's able to get that ball.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
So first down at the Minnesota 30-yard line. TCU in the second half, 3 of 3 on third down. Josh Dotson, likely an NFL receiver, 6'3", 200 pounds, transferred from Wyoming a few years ago, walked on at TCU. Had a great night. Boykin, off play action, got a man wide open. Throw the hands of Emmanuel Porter. I don't know if Boykin was upset with Porter or upset with himself for not completing that pass.
Blown coverage. Porter's running wide open down the middle of the field, and sometimes quarterbacks will try to lead that receiver in that situation. That ball's thrown a little bit behind and high to Emmanuel Porter. He knows. you go all night, you're having a, this is a good defense they're going against, and you got Murray and Body Calhoun, you got a guy wide open, and you missed the layup.
So it's second and 10. Here's Green. They finally bottle him up. He's been running between the tackles with ease. But Robert Dondelay got off a block, made a tackle. So third down and long for TCU.
That last third down situation, Tracy Clay, as a defensive coordinator, brought everybody in an all-out blitz situation. See if he decides to bring pressure again.
And Julian Huff, keep an eye on him there, about the 23-yard line. Well, backs off. Boykin hit as he throws, and it's picked off by Murray. They got pressure on Boykin, and he throws an interception. Minnesota ball.
It was Alex Keith, the backup defensive end, number 9, that came with a spin move and got to Trevon Boykin. Here he is at the top here. He's going to come. He's going to get the pressure. And the ball's thrown errant. And Eric Murray's in perfect position. Great move by Keith. Affects that throw. And again, yet again, Minnesota gets a turnover in their end of the field.
Teams didn't throw a lot at Murray last year. Had just one interception. Guy that didn't receive any college offers. But Mel Kiper has him as the second best senior cornerback prospect. And that was a huge play to keep Minnesota's hopes alive of the upset. Obviously, they got to get something going on this side of the ball. Leitner on the run. Can he beat his man? No. Had he might still be running. It was him and Nick Orr out there on the island. And Orr made the play. So a short game.
Great play by Nick Orr. Only 165 pounds. And Leitner goes 240. Great job of getting him on the ground. We haven't seen Leitner run the ball a lot in this game. And that's normally the 1-2 punch of the running backs, Roderick Williams and Leitner. That's the kind of balance they have in the running game. Love to see Leitner run more in the second half.
Only 6 attempts on the ground. Second and 6. They go to the quick passing game. Eric Carter gets a couple yards. The ball is out, but they rule him down. Denzel Johnson on the tackle. So third and long here for Minnesota. midway through the third quarter, down two scores.
I'm not so sure that ball wasn't out. Denzel Johnson comes up, gets a hat on the ball. It's hard to tell. Like Anthony Tejada stripped it.
Ooh, I think you might be right. I think that may have come out, but no signal down to the referee, so it stands. Third down and a completion. Walutarski stays in. Finally, they get a big play in the passing game, and Minnesota is inside the TCU 45.
Just a simple breakdown in coverage. That's Nick Orr, who made the play two plays ago, just misses the tackle on the outside, and now Minnesota in a hurry-up situation.
Leidner on the run. Dragged down by Kenny Iloka after a gain of about five at the 37-yard line.
Yeah, and Leidner needs to lower that shoulder. He's got 240 pounds. These guys are not as big as him. He needs to inflict some pain. Style points are out the window.
He'll throw here. Whoa, dangerous pass, and it's dropped by Williams. Man, Caraway jumped into the air, timed that throw by Leidner. I don't know if Leidner saw him when he went to throw that ball. Incomplete. So third down and five. Is Minnesota in four down territory yet?
I think so, yeah. That being said, I would run Leidner here to the outside, back-to-back plays in this drive. It's been successful.
Leidner into traffic, and it's caught short of the first down. Walutarski on the grab, and Minnesota's going to go for it on fourth down.
Yeah, they got to go for it. And if I were them, I would have gone no huddle, and I would have got up there, and I would have run the sneak with Leidner. That's about 2 yards. Maybe that's too – Jerry Kill thinks that's too long for a quarterback sneak.
It would be about a 51-yard field goal from here for Ryan Santoso, who made a 52-yarder last season. Minnesota breaks the huddle with 11 on the play clock. Fourth and two. Play clock down to two.
Timeout.
Yeah, I'm out. He had two guys moving that time. And Minnesota burns a timeout. 6:13 on the clock in the third. Minnesota down 17-3. Fourth and two coming up.
That fourth down play called in your head before you run the third down play. Looks like they didn't have it.
And Leidner going to throw here on fourth down, and the catch is made by KJ May at the 27. I mean, if you had to think of a play that they would call there, that was probably the last thing, right, on fourth down. A drop back pass by Leidner, no play action. Wow.
Give him credit. He had pressure in the pocket. Take a look at the pocket. It was collapsing. They brought a blitzer up front. He had to throw that ball on time. Nice job by KJ May going down and making a play.
A good play by the junior quarterback Mitch Leidner, converting, keeping the chains moving. Fresh set of downs at the 27. Rodney Smith finds a gap inside the 15. Spun down at the 12. A 15-yard run for Rodney Smith.
Start to see some of the athletic ability and what his coaches are so excited in this redshirt freshman from Georgia. He makes great instinctual cuts, gets to that second level, and then that shallow cut right there and a spin after. You can see the athletic ability that Rodney Smith brings to the table.
Ninth play of the drive coming up. They're at the 12-yard line of TCU. Smith again finds another crease inside the five, driven down by Iloka, but after about 8 yards off the right edge.
Gary Patterson talked about pulling the guards. Here's Christensen, the left guard. He's going to wrap around and get the block. This is the change in scheme that Matt Limegrover started in the first half that Gary Patterson said was hurting him, and it's hurting him again in the second.
Second down and two inside the five. Leidner will keep it this time, and he tries to power to the goal line. He got the first down, but came up short of pay dirt. First and goal coming up from the one. He ran harder, it seemed, on that play, right?
You start to smell the end zone, you know. The quarterback, there's no time to hold anything back here. You got to give it all you got.
First and goal at the one. Leidner keeps. Leidner hammered. Wow. Garrett Kindred and Mike Tuaua smack him at the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, but he delivered a blow to Tuaua. Take a look at this. I mean, he ran over the defensive end. Kindred got the best of him, but Kindred just cleaned it up.
Leidner was a defensive end in high school. His brother, Matt, is a center.
Give him a break. Give it to the running back here, will you?
Rodney Smith back there with Leidner. Leidner's carried it the last two times. It's Smith.
Thank you.
He's in. A Minnesota touchdown to get within a score.
That's a gritty drive. That's a gritty drive. Fourth down conversion. Some tough runs by your quarterback, your young tailback, and Rodney Smith making some plays. That's a kind of drive that you can build something on.
What does it say about the confidence the coaches have in Mitch Leidner on that fourth down, having him drop back to throw the ball? And he made the play. 12 play, 77 yard. Touchdown drive to get Minnesota within seven. Rodney Smith's first. Touchdown. All right, our Aflac trivia question. When's the last time Minnesota beat a top five ranked team? I know the last time they beat a top five team at home was in 1977 against the school from Ann Arbor, but overall, when's the last time? Just wanted to make that clear it's been a while. It's a roadway.
I'm surprised you haven't been giving me updates on the score of the Michigan-Utah game while we've been going through this. But
I can't do that to you week one. You don't want to know.
See Leidner coming over on the sideline. He is well respected on this team. He is not the, as you mentioned, he's not the prettiest quarterback, doesn't throw the prettiest ball out there, but there's something to be said for toughness, and Mitch Leidner has exhibited that, and that you can be a leader and be tough, and he exhibited it on that drive.
Returnable for the speedy Listen B. But he gets leveled at the 16. Great coverage. Blake Cashman down there for the Gophers. Big hit.
Cashman played off the block. He's got the block on one shoulder. Gets off on Listen B. How many times do we see where momentum shifts in a game and a team gets back into it with a big touchdown drive, and then on the ensuing kickoff, it's all deflated. The air's out of the balloon because you give up a big return. So it's a big play by Cashman.
I don't think there's any question Minnesota's going to be a contender in the Big Ten West. It might come down to that Wisconsin game at the end of the year. They've lost 11 straight to the Badgers. And Trevon Boykin is not at quarterback. He's in the slot, and they had Desmond White lined up as the quarterback, and they got to burn a timeout. So they try a trick play. We thought we'd see some trick plays from TCU. They go to it here, and they got to burn a timeout. Boykin saw it. Desmond White saw it late, but Boykin got the timeout. Let's check in with Tom.
No, fellas, you guys were noting Mitch Leidner and how his teammates respect him. If you look at him, you look at his body language, a quarterback's body language can change an entire locker room and an entire sideline. And I've watched the mood of this football team. When he smiles, the team's upbeat. When his body language is in another direction, the team follows. The qualities of the leadership of that position, Leidner's got it going right now.
Let's see if the defense is fired up as well. Hand off to Johnson, and Johnson only got a couple of yards. Julian Huff tracking down the running back again.
You know, just to follow up on Luke's point, for all those young players out there that want to play quarterback, it is critical, your body language. Leadership is about everything you do, every little detail. And if you're the one that's charged with leading a team to victory and you don't show confidence, there's no way people are going to follow you. So it's a great point.
Boykin back to throw. And Boykin's deep pass is right on target. Emmanuel Porter with the catch. Beautifully thrown ball. And a 26-yard gain to the 44.
We talked about Emmanuel Porter emerging for this offense as the clear-cut number three option. And he's continuing to take it to Jalen Myrick on the outside.
Green wrapped up and thrown down by Fearon Cochran. They get a negative play in the run game after giving up that long pass. A setback of 2 yards.
Can Minnesota defensively continue to get a stop? They've given up some yards, and they've given up a few points, much fewer points than TCU normally scores. But as they get into this late in the third and fourth quarter, do they have enough gas left in the tank?
The fewest TCU scored last year was 30 against Minnesota. Boykin got single coverage, and there's a flag. Murray was all over Jawan Story. That'll be pass interference and a first down for TCU. That will put the ball in
pass interference by
Minnesota
number 31
territory.
Of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
Let's take a look. They're running stride for stride. He's got his arm on his back there. Pretty good call. If he didn't have his arm around his back, and if he was just running next to him and looking back and they click heels, then that's not a penalty, but he had that arm around his back. It's a pretty easy call.
Didn't get his head turned around either. Didn't see the ball, right? First down at the 43. Green off the left side. Finds a hole. Near another first down at the 33. Travis there for Minnesota. I'll mark him just short.
If I'm Doug Meacham, I'm going to continue to try to establish that running game. It's been the best thing that TCU has done offensively in this game, inside the tackles particularly.
Penalty marker down.
A false start by number 77 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
Jamel Knapp, the left guard. So second and six for TCU.
These wide splits again, Dave. These receivers all the way almost on the sideline. It's a big key indicator for run in this TCU offense.
Get that defense spread out. Only five in the box for Minnesota. And Green finds a hole. Clotheslined by Body Calhoun. A first down of the 30-yard line. Gain of 9.
And Jamel Knapp, he may have jumped off sides on the last play, but he came off on that running play and drove Steven Richardson, talented sophomore tackle.
Boykin to the air. Deep pass going for Dotson. That time Murray had good coverage, did not interfere with Dotson. Second down and 10.
You're not going to make a big living throwing the ball down the field on Eric Murray. You got a penalty. That's probably about as good as you're going to get. But in two games against TCU, Eric Murray has not given up one of those plays down the field.
Dotson, 7 catches and a touchdown in the game. Second down and 10 at the 30 of Minnesota. Green stood up, keeps the feet moving, darts back, and brought down by Demarius Travis. Should have gotten nothing, got a couple. Brings up a third down and long.
Here we go, check in. There's pass rush specialist Keith, who had that pressure on Boykin that led to the interception. He's at the top of the screen.
Third down and 8. They're 0 for 2 on third and long tonight. Boykin has time in the pass behind the intended receiver, Kyle Hicks. Fourth down and eight, and here comes the kicking team.
They tried to sneak Hicks down the middle of the field, and that's just a tight window. There's three, four Gophers in that area. Difficult play, great coverage. Great changeup by Tracy Clay's defensive coordinator. Brought all-out pressure on the last drive. This time drops in the zone and makes Trevon Boykin throw an accurate ball, and he gets an incompletion.
The last time Oberkrom kicked, he missed a 29-yarder at the end of the half. That snap is high, and this one bends through. Snap was high on the missed field goal, it seemed, as well. But he made that kick, and it's a 10-point lead for TCU in the final seconds of the third quarter. Actually, the replay looked like a better snap than it did live. Good job by Zach Allen to place it. Oberkrom makes it a 10-point game, but Jerry Kill will take it. Give up 20 points to TCU through three quarters. All right, let's answer the Aflac trivia question. The last time that Minnesota beat a top five team was on the road in 1999. Against a number two squad, Penn State. 24-23. Dan Nystrom made the game-winning field goal as time expired from 32 yards out.
LeVar Arrington team. I think LeVar Arrington was jumping over that pile. Glenn Mason.
It was interesting when Mason was no longer the coach and they were looking to hire a head coach. They ended up hiring Tim Brewster, but Gary Patterson was in the mix for the job then.
This is when TCU was in the Mountain West Conference and they were, you know, they weren't in the Big 12 yet, and it was a more enticing job.
In fact, Jerry Kill told us as that kick goes out of bounds, big mistake there by Oberkrom. He told us he advised Patterson to take the job. It wasn't offered to him. They ended up offering it to Tim Brewster. Things worked out. Patterson stayed at TCU. They made it to the big leagues in the Big 12.
Free kick out of bounds by the kicking team. Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Jerry Kill in his fifth year now at Minnesota. So with the kick out of bounds, the Gophers will have it on their 35, down 10.
And I think Jerry Kill will take this. He will take this coming into this game against the number two team in the country at the end of the third quarter, only down 10. Good field position at the 35-yard line. A little bit of momentum. Quarterback is settling in. Defense has played well. Take your best shot in the fourth quarter. See what happens.
You got Rodney Smith in the game. He's getting a lot of the touches after Roderick Williams fumbled inside the TCU five. Leidner to throw. It's Rashad Still, a true freshman. And Derek Kindred is a really good player. Senior safety. All Big 12 performer last year. He read that well and made a tackle in the open field.
Well, and Kindred is really the one that has to take over in the secondary. We talked about losing Chris Hackett, Kevin White, Sam Carter. He's the only stalwart remaining, and he's got to take these young guys under his wing. Kenny Iloka, Denzel Johnson, some of these linebackers, Traven Howard, Nico Small. There's a lot of guys that are looking to Kindred for leadership, and he's been up to the task.
They snap it before the end of the quarter, and Leidner throwing deep, and it's overthrown. There was contact downfield. There's the flag. K.J. May was being covered by Ranthony Tejada. Boykin saying it should be on May. There was contact downfield by both guys. So the question is, was May trying to get away from Tejada, who was interfering with him, or did May just push off?
Pass interference by number one of the offense. The 15-yard penalty and replay second down.
Take a look. Here he is right here. And
well, it didn't look like interference on May. The question is, was it interference on Tejada? May didn't do anything.
What happened? It looked like a double move. And when he went to go, Tejada was in the way. And
we'll have an untimed down here. Let's bring in Doug Rhodes. Rules analyst, Doug, what'd you think of the play?
Well, you can't block downfield. That's one of the things. So when he raised his arms and extended out to create some separation there, that's what would have created the foul.
Doug, it looked like he was running a double move, and when he came out of his stem, the defender was in his way. Now, the defender has the right to be in that spot, right? Equal right. So it's definitely not a block. This is a pass downfield, but it looks like he was in the way of that double move, so I can see that call.
Yeah, he just initiated the contact, I think, is what caused that. The offensive man.
So second and 26, final play of the quarter. And Smith gets about 4 or 5. And so it'll be third and close to 20 when we start the fourth quarter here in Minneapolis. With number two, TCU leading, but it's only a 10-point advantage. Not as many points as many thought the Horned Frogs would score with 10 returners, returning starters on offense. Boykins played well. 10-point lead for TCU. Heidner throwing it deep for May. Actually caught the ball, but he was out of bounds. Incomplete. So Minnesota will have to punt. Down 10 as we begin the fourth quarter. Again, they have a weapon here with their punter, Peter Mortel, at a 59-yarder early in the game.
And we haven't talked about Devontae Turpin, punt returner, in a while. True freshman, done a good job catching punts in this game. He's made that one mistake with a fair catch, and
Mortel gets off another good one. Turpin backing up at his 24-yard line, makes two guys miss. That's a nice return out to the 32-yard line after a 51-yard punt. TCU's offense back on the field. Pass, he's run for a score. He'll run here, and he's got room out near the 40-yard line, wrestled down by Eric Murray. Comes up just short of the first down. Slow to get up. In fact, he's not getting up.
Looks like he may have a cramp down there. He's pulling on his toes, and warm, humid summer night, and he's been doing a lot of running.
Going to stay in the game after that run of 8 yards. Second down and 2. 80 yards on the ground for Boykin. Made very few mistakes. Has had one interception, but that was after good pressure by the defensive line. Green off the right side, and there's a penalty marker down. Green only got back to the line of scrimmage. Alex Keith on the stop. So no gain. Let's see what the penalty's for.
Holding by number 55 of the offense. A 10-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
You know, Dave, this might seem like it's innocuous with Trevon Boykin, but he's having a hard time with that cramp. And so if I'm Tracy Clay, and I'm sitting here looking at this, the most effective thing TCU has done in this game is run Trevon Boykin, and right now I don't think he's going to run the football. So I take that out of my thinking if I'm Tracy Clay, and I defend pass, and I defend Kyle Hicks from a running back position. I take that running element of the quarterback out of this equation.
How hard is it to throw as a quarterback when you're cramping in your legs?
It's a lot easier to throw it than it is to run it.
Oh, yeah.
When you're cramping.
Second down and 11. And Boykin, beautiful throw. Desmond White to the 46-yard line.
Like I said, Dave, it's easier to throw when you're just to run. That's a great throw from behind. Look at the anticipation, the accuracy, and the timing, the things that Trevon Boykin has been working on all summer, and they're starting to show up. And again, I talk about the middle of the field as that was an area of growth for Trevon Boykin. We knew he could throw the ball on the outside deep, but when you have Dez White, Kevontae Turkins, Lenina, middle of the field is a weapon.
Yet White again. Wrapped up by Boddy Calhoun, short game. Now, we've really only seen one errant pass over the middle, and it was on that last possession when they were in the red zone. He threw it behind the receiver. Granted, there were four Minnesota players around that receiver.
Yeah, and he did miss the one to Emmanuel Porter in the seam for the touchdown. But other than that, you know, there haven't been a whole lot of really good windows on the outside, but on the inside of the field, as Tom was talking about with his passing chart, he has been more accurate.
Turpin with a stiff arm, and oh, nice cut there. Boddy Calhoun thought he had an easy wrap-up. Turpin shook him, picked up a couple yards, so huge third down here.
little bit of joystick in 25.
True freshman, 152 pounds. He's their number one punt returner. We've seen him and redshirt freshman Sean Nixon. Other than Dotson, they might be the biggest weapons Boykin have on offense. And they weren't even part of that team that was number two in the country last year in scoring. Third down and four at the Minnesota 41.
Keep an eye on the edge. Julian Huff, number 20.
Boykin's pass is caught, but short of the first down. Myrick tried to jump that route intended for Story. They'll give him forward progress to the 38, so it's fourth and one. What do you do?
Great break by Jalen Myrick. Take a look. He's looking in the backfield. He reads the formation. He reads the set by the wide receiver and split and jumps that route.
You surprised? On fourth and one, they're not going to go for it. They're going to punt the ball.
Well, I just think that they feel real good about their defense and Minnesota's inability to drive the length of the field. Much like in the first drive, you said, why are they attempting a field goal here? It's the same situation. Now they're going to punt it down and make Minnesota execute on offense to beat them.
Ethan Perry will try to pin the Gophers deep and got a penalty flag.
Just going to take the delay of game and back it up.
A delay of game by the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty and it's still fourth down.
Now you take any concern of a fake out of the picture, right, if you're Minnesota. Now it's fourth and six. You're not as concerned about that as you might have been on fourth and one. And now Minnesota makes a bunch of substitutions, or at least they try to on special teams.
Yeah, they had their punt safe, as they call it out there, which is just their base defense playing for a fake. I think they're still going to do that.
Good punt. Oh, dangerous play by James. He felt he was interfered with. He might have a point. He signaled for the fair catch.
A mistake there by James. You don't want to catch that ball inside the 10-yard line. It's the worst thing you can do. You're doing the job for the punt team for him.
It's over his head as well.
Yeah.
And Buick, proud partner of the NCAA.
The athletic training staff for TCU working on Trevon Boykin, who was cramming up on that last drive. Minnesota backed up, first and 10 on its four, down 10 points. How many possessions will the Gophers have in the last 11 minutes? Power run game with Roderick Williams, and he gets only a couple. Mike Freeze, true freshman, seems like he's held up okay in there.
You know, he was a big question mark. We started out in the telecast talking about the true freshman starting at the Mike linebacker position, taking over for Paul Dawson. A lot of new names, Sammy Douglas, Ty Summers, Denzel Johnson. This TCU defense has come to play tonight. Hasn't been all perfect. Not playing against the most explosive offense here in Minnesota. I understand that. But I think Gary Patterson's got to be happy with the way that his starting 11 on defense have played.
8-1 for Williams on first down. Widener off play action, throwing from his end zone, and he is brought down for a safety. Or did he get out? The ball came out, an offensive lineman had it. Brian Bobek, how did he end up with a ball? The ruling is that Bobek made it out of the end zone.
Well, the ball came out of Widener's hand. I think they're going to rule it as a fumble. And then the question is, where did the ball...
Unless he threw it to him.
The ruling on the field is that the quarterback intentionally grounded the ball in the end zone. It's a safety.
Mike Freeze had pressure that time, and so it's 22-10. TCU.
We got pressure on the inside. Latham came in. Lawson was there. At this point, looked like they ruled that that arm was coming forward. Take a look at his right arm. It's coming forward. Is this a pass?
Yeah, and there's no receiver in the area. So intentional grounding is the call. 22-10.
Time is the offensive line.
Was intentional grounding in the end zone for
that offensive line.
The previous play is under further review.
So they're going to look to see if it was a forward pass. I would imagine that's what they're checking, just to confirm that it was a forward pass and incomplete. Because if it was a fumble, anybody can pick it up. Let's bring Doug Rhodes in, our rules analyst. Is that what you presume they're looking at here, Doug, is whether his arm was going forward and trying to confirm it was a forward pass?
Yeah, that's correct. That is one of the reviewable plays. If you have a foul in the end zone like that to determine, you know, the status of it. In this case here, there's pretty good evidence his arm is moving forward with the ball. You'll see it, you know, it's not much, but again, if an empty hand comes forward, then that's where you'd rule a fumble. But if there's any indication that the ball is in his hand when it's coming forward, that should be a forward pass.
You know, that
very
look,
slight.
That look right there, that last look, makes me want to question that, Doug, because you talk about open hand. The helmet hit his elbow, and then I think his hand did open. That's not as cut and dry as I thought initially.
But didn't it look like he's trying to throw it anyway?
Take a look at this right here.
Doesn't look though. He's like he's trying to throw it. He sees a teammate, and he's just trying to get rid of it.
He's trying to throw, but again, that's what replay has to evaluate in here. Is it enough, you know, to show that the hand is coming forward?
Yeah.
There is no receiver in the area. Can't throw it forward to an offensive lineman.
Which would be intentional grounding in all cases since there's no eligible receiver in the area. But the foul is determined by the spot where he threw it from, so hence the safety.
Well, okay, and if we really want to try to stump you, Doug, we're working you out here on the first night of college football, but if we really want to stump you, if this is a fumble, it was picked up, and then, you know, what's the ruling after that? Because
so it is third down and 14. At the Minnesota 1. And it's back to 20-10, TCU. Play action. Leidner going deep to the sideline. Incomplete. Rashad Still, the intended receiver. TCU had excellent coverage. Nick Orr, sophomore, was running with the freshman Rashad Still. Minnesota will punt.
One of the questions for TCU coming in to this season, who's going to replace Kevin White? And Nick Orr's got the first opportunity in this game. He's the one that won the job in the preseason camp. I know he's running with a true freshman there in Rashad Still, but that was well done. Looking back for the football, being in good position, confident move by Orr.
All Big Ten punter, Peter Mortel, needed desperately here. Kicking to the true freshman, Kevontae Turpin. He's been very dangerous with the ball in his hands tonight. Delay of game. Can't move much closer.
A delay of game by the offense. The penalty's half the distance to the goal, and it's still fourth down.
The official picked up the ball, walked about 2 inches, and put it down. That's half the distance.
Another delay of game?
All right, Bill. That's in November, all right? Don't start that in September.
Some flashbacks.
Mortel will punt. Turpin standing at his 42-yard line. High kick. Turpin hit immediately. He did not signal for the fair catch. Keontae Harden was there for the Gophers. All right, let's take a look at our top 10. TCU ranked number 2. Talked about Ohio State and Virginia Tech on Monday and Alabama, Wisconsin. Saturday night on ABC. And TCU won 12 games last year, as everybody knows, left out of the playoff. Big 12 didn't adjust going to a Big 12 conference championship game. Now again, the Big 12 is unique in that everybody plays one another during the regular season. Will that be a factor again? Boykin on first down. Dotson had Murray turned around in a big game.
Well, and you think about probably the entire college football playoff, you know, selection committee, hopefully watching this game. They knew what this game meant in last year's proceedings and that decision-making process. After this game, TC really is pretty clear sailing till they get to the bottom quarter of their schedule when they go on the road, Oklahoma State, Oklahoma, and then Baylor. So how much will the style points come into the equation? Probably quite a bit.
On first down, Johnson didn't see a hole inside, tried to run outside and lost yardage. Setback of a yard or two. So assuming that TCU, and it's certainly not dumb, we got 9 minutes left, wins tonight, do they have to go undefeated? Or Baylor, Oklahoma, do they have to go undefeated based on last year and what you saw with the playoff selection committee to make it into the Final Four?
I don't think there's any question, Dave, that they have to go undefeated. I think especially in the Big 12. Obviously, the big bone of contention was there wasn't a championship game, and that affected them. And Gary Patterson understands it. They decided as a conference, Bob Bowlesby not to institute that championship game, and so they're gonna play their cards.
Boykin's pass is incomplete, but Murray's gonna get flagged again. Emmanuel Porter, the intended receiver.
And this is not something that you normally see Eric Murray do. He's in great position, didn't need to put his left hand on the receiver.
Number 31 of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
He tried to get a hand on the ball. Just take a look at his left hand. All you need to see is his left hand. That left hand goes up over the shoulder. Didn't need to do it either. And that's for any quarterback, you have certain structural things you don't do. And for a corner, that's one of those things that you don't do. It's not something you normally see from him.
So first down of the Minnesota 21, TCU by 10, 8.5 to go. Boykin off another play fake, wide open in the end zone was Sean Nixon, but Boykin overthrew him. And Minnesota can hold and force a field goal try. They're still down two scores. They catch a break there.
Great design here. There's a post, a wheel, and then another wheel. And that's tough to defend. You're basically overloading that seam. A second time Trevon Boykin has missed a wide open receiver screaming towards the end zone.
Second and 10 of the 21. Boykin setting up a screen. There was contact again by Murray. No flag this time. Boy, it looked like he got there early, didn't it? Third and 10.
Absolutely. Absolutely. This is a screen. He hits the receiver way before the ball gets there. Should have been pass interference. It would have been his third of the night.
Would have been a first down. Instead, third and 10 at the 21. Minnesota in a must-stop situation. See numbers for Boykin on third down. 4 of 8 with a pick. Out of an empty set, Boykin will run. And Boykin grabbed at the 16 by Julian Huff.
Great
DC will bring on the field goal unit.
Great play by Julian Huff. He fights off a block. He's got a big offensive guard downfield blocking him. And he has to fight that off and then tackle in the open field one of the most explosive players in all of college football. None of us have seen Julian Huff play. First game in college football, he's got a bright future ahead of him.
And now Overcrome, who is 2 of 3. His shortest attempt was a miss, a 29-yarder at the end of the first half. This is a 33-yard attempt. And he splits the uprights. 13-point lead for TCU. 7:33 on the clock in the fourth quarter. How many quarterbacks will play in that game for Ohio State? Will it be Cardell Jones, JT Barrett, and how will the Ohio State offensive coaching staff use Braxton Miller in that game? We know he's going to play some receiver. TCU kicking off, Minnesota down 13, needing two scores, and this possession will start on the 25. Let's take a look at tonight's AT&T Strong performance. Trevon Boykin threw for under 100 yards in the first half, but 238, a touchdown, also a rushing score on the night.
You know, I think it hasn't been all pretty for Trevon Boykin, but when he's needed to make plays, especially with his legs, he's made them. He hasn't been pinpoint accurate on all throws, in missing a couple throws downfield for touchdowns, but you know, that first game, you just want to knock some of the rust off. And they're on the road. They weren't a great road team a year ago. Gary Patterson was very vocal about that. Games against Kansas and Texas, West Virginia, wasn't happy with their performance. And so to come on the road here and play the way they did, some good, some bad, a lot to learn from.
Rodney Smith, nice carry on first down. Got a handful. TCU's not out of the woods if Minnesota can somehow put together a length of the field scoring drive, something they couldn't really do last year and struggled to do obviously tonight. Smith is stopped short of the first down by about 2 yards by Derek Kindred, third down.
I mean, it's a 13-point lead on the scoreboard, but the way that this offense from Minnesota has been performing today, it feels like it's a 23-point lead, you know?
And look, Mitch Leidner is playing as well as he possibly can, but if they had an upgrade at that position, this would be a much better team. This would be a team that could definitely challenge in the Big Ten. They might be able to challenge in the West as it is. Rodney Smith appears to have the first down on the ground and move the chains.
Well, I don't think there's any question they're going to challenge in the West. I would almost call them a favorite in the West. I mean, I know that Wisconsin is going to be there as well. Last year it came down to the game against Minnesota and Wisconsin, and Minnesota actually got out to a 14-point lead in that game early. And if they protect the football.
Leidner got hit, and that's why the ball fluttered like that. Pressure by Lathan, incomplete.
They protect the football. If they can protect the football, continue to play defense the way that they've played here tonight, and they did a year ago, they'll be in every single ball game they play in the Big Ten.
There's no doubt this is a program on the rise. It's been a while for Minnesota Golden Gopher fans, but all the headlines in the paper, almost the entire sports portion of the newspaper full of Golden Gopher excitement and anticipation for this game. Leidner put it on the money there. Nicely done to Eric Carter in TCU territory.
See, it's guys like that, guys like Eric Carter and some of the athletes they've added on the perimeter that should significantly upgrade this team outside of what we're seeing out of the quarterback position right now. But in comparison to their competitors and their peers in the West, this was a team that challenged it last year, as we see Mitch Leidner taking it on his own. We talked about it coming into this broadcast. Couldn't give up field position, couldn't give up turnovers. They did both of those things in the first quarter. They rebound because they play great defense and they can effectively run the football. The quarterback position is the X factor for them in the Big Ten.
Rodney Smith on second down gets a couple. They'll be in third and manageable. Well, even with their offensive issues last year, they hung with Ohio State. They hung with Wisconsin.
They beat Michigan.
Beat Nebraska for the second straight year.
And they got some young guys on the perimeter that can play. They can run, they can play.
And Leidner can't convert that to Wozniak, who's 6'10". Minnesota will go for it on fourth down.
You know, and that's a perfect example right there. Big third and four situation. You got your tight end in the flat. You give them an accurate ball, a foot in front of the numbers, and you move the change and you move on. But it's the details of the passing game that have not been there for Minnesota. And it's not from lack of trying, lack of work. It's just something that Jerry Kill knows, tried to address in the offseason. And it's going to continue to be a work in progress.
Fourth down and four at the 42-yard line. Yeah, big penalty there. If it's on Minnesota.
A false start by number 77 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's fourth down.
You can't have that if you're Foster Bush. Can't be doing that fourth and four. Now you're fourth and nine. Still go for it here? Got to, right? 5:28?
Yeah.
They converted a fourth and two in the third quarter to keep a drive alive and eventually get a touchdown. Now fourth and nine, Leidner forced to throw, we would imagine. Leidner has time, and the pass is incomplete. Underthrown, Tejada had coverage on Rashad Still, and Minnesota turns it over on down. Obviously, the Gophers' goal is to win the Big Ten. They have to go to Colorado State, a couple of home games after that before they enter conference play. They don't have to play Michigan State nor Penn State. They go to Ohio State, but they have Nebraska, Michigan, Wisconsin all here in Minneapolis.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the recipe for them is they've got to create some turnovers on defense, have some special teams play that help them in field position so their offense doesn't have to drive the length of the field. And that's in the games they were successful in a year ago. That was the recipe from Jerry Kill. This team, you know, fundamentally, this team will be as well coached as any in the country. He is considered one of the top 10 coaches in all of college football, if you ask a college football coach. And it's just that position on the offense as a leader and his ability to pull the trigger and have balance throwing the football is a perfect example of that last throw, grossly underthrown. You got to have that if you're going to make a step to the next level and beat the Wisconsins and get to the Big Ten championship game and not get blown out 59-0 like Wisconsin did to Ohio State, right? So, but I think this is a program that's headed in the right direction with the absolute right coach. And a lot of young talent on the offensive side that I think will grow together. He was talking about some of the young quarterbacks. Chris Streveler, obviously the backup of Demery Croft, is a guy that I know that they're excited about. Young guy needs to grow into his body. So there's something to look forward to for Minnesota.
We'll keep it on the ground on 2nd and 6. And Green tripped up by Jack Lynn. He loses a couple yards, so 3rd and long. And Minnesota, knowing that absolutely has to get a stop here to have any shot. Down 13, 3rd and 9 for TCU. Anything that concerns you about TCU? Ranked number 2 in the preseason. 10 starters back in offense. Loses some guys on defense. Without a couple guys tonight on top of that because of injury.
If I were Gary Patterson, I'd be very encouraged by the way his defense played. He got a game under the belt of some of those young players on that defensive side. Some experience for them that will be invaluable.
Boykin throws complete. First time we've called the name of Ty Slanina. He had 32 catches a year ago. He's just short of a first down. It's TCU go 4th and 4th and 1.
I think
they're going to kick it.
They're going to kick it. But to finish that point, you asked me what concerns do I have. You know, the one concern that I always have with these styles of offenses, up tempo and spread them out, is can they finish a game in the fourth quarter with the ball on the ground? And then we go back to that Baylor game. If they're able to run the football on the ground in the fourth quarter up 21, they win that football game. That's my biggest question. And to be honest with you, watching the way that this offensive line has played in this game and 4 seniors back, I'm encouraged by that as well.
Remember, Baylor, like TCU, similar offense, a great punt here. In the bowl game, Baylor against Michigan State blew a 20-point lead in the fourth quarter like TCU did against Baylor. All right, College Game Day built by the Home Depot. 3 hours of the best college football analysis with Herbie Dez, Coach Corso, and Reese Davis hosting 9 a.m. from Fort Worth, Texas.
But I don't think that TCU, you know, when we look at TCU from around the country, everybody sees the flashy offense and the Heisman Trophy front runner. What you don't see last year was 40 turnovers by their defense. They were top 10 scoring defense, and now you don't see that offensive line, 4 out of 5 seniors that come back. Those are the differences for TCU, in my opinion, between last year and this year.
Minnesota's ball on the 9-yard line. Leidner hits Wolitarski. He's out past the 20-yard line.
As we've watched Trevon Boykin grow today, you know, we did the passing chart with the first half throws. Everything's underneath, not a lot downfield. We saw a little bit more of that as we see a stop and play here, timeout for TCU on defense and Gary Patterson's crew. You start to see him develop some progression reads, things that he needed to evolve in. But in talking to Gary Patterson about what he wants out of the quarterback, and if you look at their schedule, on the road in Stillwater, on the road in Norman, on the road in Manhattan, Kansas, you know you're going to expect a good ball game there. Offensively, you got to expect Texas Tech's going to be pretty good. That's in Lubbock. He needs his quarterback in 3 areas. Play well on the road, 3rd down, and in the red area. Those 3 things for Trevon Boykin could win him the Heisman Trophy, but will also, more importantly, determine their fate in the Big 12.
Well, we know with obviously just 4 spots available, somebody in the power conferences going to get left out. It was the Big 12 last year, in part because no Big 12 championship game. And I don't know, given that schedule that you just talked about, Tom, the TCU can run the table. 1st down, and Rodney Smith out to the 35-yard line for 12 yards. That'll stop the clock as they reset the chains. 2:47 to go. And Baylor's got a much easier non-conference schedule again. Stephen F. Austin, SMU tomorrow night as Leitner delivers into SMU territory to Brandon Lingen. 1st down at the 49 of TCU.
Great throw under pressure. Leitner took a big hit in the backfield and delivered.
And run it again. Smith Good run by Smith to the 43. Clock moving. 6-yard run. Minnesota with two timeouts remaining. You know they got to hustle. Second and four. Leidner hits still, and he gets the first down. So the clock will stop momentarily with 2:06 to go. Need a touchdown. Need to get the onside kick and score again.
This Minnesota team, you know, they've been practicing for the first time. There's no huddle offense all spring and in the fall, and it's having an effect and helping them in the two-minute drill.
Leidner running here. Runs over a couple of defenders. I think we'll see more of this from Minnesota this season. No huddle.
You know, I think so. If they can get healthy on the offensive line, and talking with Coach Kill, that was his biggest concern coming into this game was the health of his offensive line. But if they're healthy and can rotate, I think we will see more.
Leidner, nice toss. Still, and he gets out of bounds at the 22-yard line with 1:37 to go.
Starting to build a little confidence in the passing game. I know it's late. It might not be enough, but every little bit counts. You know, you get a freshman wide receiver out there catching balls, and Leidner getting some confidence throwing the football. You don't want to end a game and have to go a whole week with negative thoughts in your mind as a quarterback throwing the football. And even if a drive like this can get some confidence back.
Play action. Leidner with time. Got May wide open and a touchdown. Strike by Mitch Leidner. The Gophers not done yet. Minute 32 to go and two timeouts remaining. 8-play, 91-yard scoring drive.
Well, and you got the sense that TCU defensively fell asleep on that last drive. There was no pass rush. They didn't get to Mitch Leidner, and the coverage on the back end was spotty at best.
Penalty marker thrown before the snap.
A false start by number 55 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty enforced on the try.
That moves it back 5 yards. Connor Mays, who was recruited by TCU. Dad played there as well. Made the mistake. Santoso will try again. It's a 6-point game.
Go back and take a look at that touchdown. Plenty of time in the pocket for Leidner. Here's KJ May. He's just going to come up the middle of the field. Call the switch route, double move on the linebacker. That's Ty Summers. And I'll tell you, Dave, it doesn't matter what it looks like as long as it gets there. It doesn't have to be a pretty spiral. It just needs to get there.
Thing was moving a lot of different directions, but it made it to number one.
I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt. Maybe, you know, that ball came up a little wet, the center dripping on it, sweating, all that other stuff. Let's give him the benefit of the doubt.
Keep in mind, one of the new rules on the onside kicks, you can't block before 10 yards. Obviously, the offense can't touch it until either it goes 10 yards or the defense touches it, but you can't block either. Well, in terms of replay, whether the replay can review that, that's what's different about that. Let's see if Minnesota can come up with a recovery. And that was not a good onside kick. Went right to Lissenby. And Minnesota does have two timeouts remaining, so still a chance if it can get a stop, force a punt, but that was not good by Emmett Carpenter. So 23-17 is the score. TCU ball with a minute 32 remaining. Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville. Still warm and humid down on the field, but we haven't seen too many players cramping up save Trevon Boykin, who has thrown for 246 yards, a touchdown. He also has a rushing score. TCU turned it over twice inside the Minnesota 30, but Minnesota turned it over inside the TCU 5. Much better offense from Minnesota in the second half.
So here's a good example. Here's a good example. Can TCU run out the clock?
Boykin knows he's got to stay in bounds. Only a 2-yard gain. So a timeout by Minnesota. One remaining for the Gophers. 1:25 on the clock.
We just saw an unconventional formation for TCU with only two wide receivers in the game, two tight ends, and a back. And so I think this is Gary Patterson right now saying, you know, can we do this? We need to practice this. We need to be able to finish games in the fourth quarter. I don't want to have to rely on throwing the ball all over the lot, giving an incompletion, and giving the ball right back to the other team.
They weren't in too many close games last year. They had that tight one with West Virginia, the kick late to win it, a close one against Baylor that they had the 21-point lead that they blew and lost by three in the fourth quarter on the road.
Yeah, and this is a fundamental part of having a championship football team. And you watched Ohio State that did this very well, and they finished and cleaned out games in the fourth quarter and made it not even close. You've got to be able to run out that clock, make them take those timeouts, and squeeze the end of the game.
Second and eight, one timeout left for Minnesota. Boykin grabbed at the 40-yard line. So there's the final timeout. Cody Polk on the stop. It'll be a third down and five. And again, if they can get a stop, force a punt, they may only have 30 or 35 seconds to work with. But crazy things have happened. You know, I don't think people realize going in how tough of a team Minnesota is. I mean, this is a really good win on the road for TCU. You know, people look at the score if it ends 23-17 and say, man, maybe TCU's got some issues. But I think Gary Patterson will tell you this is an excellent win for us.
Well, they take on the character of their coach, which is gritty. And how many times in this game did we see the grit of Mitch Leidner? Did we see the grit of that defense? Some of the younger players and Julian Huff have made a bunch of plays in this game. This is a well-coached, tough football team. And any win, no matter what the score is, any win against this Minnesota team is a good win, especially here at home.
This is it here. Third down and four. First down for TCU. Essentially wins the game. Minnesota gets a stop. They got one more shot. Here's Green, and he is tackled short of the marker. So the clock will run. Minnesota can't stop it. It's fourth down at the 38-yard line. And TCU may take it down and call a timeout around 35, 36 seconds left. You would imagine Gary Patterson would punt the ball, not go for it on fourth down and two.
I think he'll probably actually take the delay of game and just back up five and punt this ball down there inside the 10.
The last punt was pretty good by Ethan Perry. Backed Minnesota up inside the 10. In fact, they've been backed up twice inside their own 10 in this second half. So they are going to take the delay and not use the timeout. 31 seconds left. Coming up next, Jim Harbaugh's debut as the Michigan head coach. Tom Brady's suspension lifted. And Tim Tebow trying to earn a roster spot with the Philadelphia Eagles.
And don't think that Gary Patterson won't use that last series right there of his offense. He wanted them to finish the game on the field. And so even if they end up winning this game, he's going to take that film out, show it to them maybe every single week and say, you guys have to be able to get a first down on the ground to finish a game. And I don't want to punt this football.
Minnesota's going to come after this one. 33 seconds left. Perry just gets it away. And this one will sail into the end zone for a touchback. 6 seconds off the clock. So Minnesota 80 yards away from perhaps a victory. Now they don't have any timeouts, and they have a quarterback that has struggled throwing the football. But he's coming off a touchdown pass. Confidence is up. We'll see if he can make some plays here. Clock will stop on first downs to move the chains.
And that's what you have to use to your advantage in these situations with no timeouts when you're in college. You just want to get the ball down around the 40, 45-yard line of the completion and tell your team in the huddle, as soon as we get a completion, get up on the line of scrimmage, and I'm going to clock it. We can't waste any seconds.
Leidner into traffic. May couldn't come up with it. The pass was underthrown. That would have gotten him to close to the 40-yard line.
That's a perfect example. It was the right decision by Mitch Leidner. Just the throw was short. And that ball's caught. It's perfect. You're on the 45-yard line, get up and spike the football. You just want to get a chance to, at this point, have a couple of Hail Mary shots.
Yep. 22 seconds remaining. No timeouts. A short pass, and Leidner almost threw an interception to Chris Bradley. He was trying to dump it off to his back, Roderick Williams. 18 seconds left.
And Bradley, nice job reading. I think he felt that back try to slip out behind him. Bradley's playing in place of the injured Davion Pearson. Did a nice job in this game.
Third and 10, 18 seconds left. TCU rushes four. Leidner steps up, dumps it off to Williams, and he's brought down. 10 seconds left. They can't spike it. They got to run a play here on fourth down. A TCU does have a player down in the backfield. 3 seconds left. 2-1. They got to snap it, and they didn't snap it in time.
That's it.
That's the end of the game. TCU hangs on. Knocks off Minnesota 23-17.
Don't think that there's not a huge relief on the part of Gary Patterson coming up here and getting that win. Look at him, his buddy Jerry Kill. They didn't want to play this series. They're happy to get it over.
The TCU ranked number 2 in the country. Wins its opener 23-17 over Minnesota. Coming up next on ESPN, it's SportsCenter. For Brian Griese, Tom Luganville, our entire crew, I'm Dave Pasch. So long from Minneapolis. SportsCenter coming your way next.